Check 1, 2, testing. Ooh. Let's see what we got going on here.
Check 1, 2, check. 1, 2.
The sound distorted to you?
Check. 1, 2, 3, check.
All right, testing 1, 2, 3, check 1, 2. Is it too hot or maybe?
Check 1, 2, 3, check 1, 2.
Is that better?
Three.
Check 1, 2. Yeah, that's better. Headsets are good, yeah. Sounds a little hollow, though. Is it is your mic? Oh.
I don't have my mic on.
Maybe now. That might be better. Yeah, that's better. Check 1, 2, testing 1, 2. Okay. Yeah, we're good.
theirs is not steep. Theirs is kind of like this. And they only allow two guys at a time. And each guy, you know, something like that. I don't think they're like everybody.
It's a key North Coast Athletic Conference showdown here in Springfield, where the Wittenberg Tigers entertain the DePaul Tigers, the last two remaining unbeatens in NCAC action. Hi, everybody. Alongside the coach, Jim Scobie, I'm Scott Leo. So glad that you are with us here this afternoon. It is a cool, rainy fall afternoon, and it is, as we said, a big one on the calendar. The winner of this game takes sole possession of first place in the conference standings. Coach Scobie, this is a Wittenberg team that has already surpassed their efforts of a year ago with the way they've played. A big win at Denison, most notably in the conference schedule. But now we get to a stretch where it's going to make or break the season. DePaul today, Wabash, and Ohio Wesleyan to follow. Jim Collins' team has a tough road ahead, and they're going to have to start it by trying to beat the defending conference champs.
You know, Jim Collins, I talked to him this week, and he said, you know, this is why you come to Wittenberg to play in these kinds of games. And he said that his staff and his players have really taken the challenge. They like the idea that they're going up against an undefeated team, a team that they beat last year in Indiana. And this is going to be a fun game. And I'm telling you, Wittenberg really matches up in many ways. And I think they can really, you know, show the world that that they're the team to watch, to beat in the NCAC. This win would really set them up for maybe even a final game against Wabash, although there's a lot of football left. But I think the Tigers come into this with a lot of energy, with a lot of confidence. And, of course, DePaul, after their loss last week, or actually their win last week against Denison, 17-6, a team that Wittenberg beat earlier, I think this is setting up nicely for the Wittenberg Tigers.
Max Melton, the Wittenberg junior quarterback, has completed 68% of his passes on the year, 1 yard shy of 1,300 through the air, 15 touchdowns to just 5 interceptions. His counterpart would be Nathan McCahill, the junior quarterback for the DePaul Tigers. And McCahill has thrown for just over 1,600 yards, completing 63% of his passes, 21 touchdowns, and only 2 interceptions. Captains meet at midfield for the pregame coin toss. This will be the 17th meeting all time between the Tigers and the Tigers. Wittenberg has won 12 of the first 16, including DePaul's only loss last year, that Wittenberg victory over in Greencastle. Now, last week, DePaul took care of Worcester on the road, 53-7. DePaul dominated that game from the outset. Coach Scobie, you mentioned the win against Denison, 17-6, 2 weeks ago. They began the conference slate with a 49-0 blistering of Hiram. They, at home, took care of Ohio Wesleyan 28-7, and they won at Oberlin 66-7. As for Wittenberg's conference schedule this year, 56-17 at home, a winner over Kenyon. You made reference to that overtime victory in Granville where they beat the Denison Big Red 27-24, beat Hiram here at home 21-7, handled Oberlin last week on the road 72-7, largest output in the Jim Collins era here at Wittenberg by far last week, the 72 points scored at Oberlin. DePaul wins the toss. They'll defer till the second half. Wittenberg will receive and head towards the south end zone, and Coach Scobie will get a look at that Wittenberg Tigers offense to start the day.
Yeah, and it's very important that Wittenberg starts out fast. They've got to come out They've got to set the tone early, get into a rhythm, a drive on the first play, and the first plays of the game would just be absolutely great if you get a touchdown or even a field goal. But a touchdown would really set things up. So Jim Collins knows that, and I got to believe that they'll be aggressive early. Defensively, it's a really good DePaul team. They had four sacks last week. Comer, Guide, Nolan, and Gould and Siebel. They had a pair or half of a sack together. This is a team that will come after you, and defensively, they're pretty sound.
Wittenberg on offense, when you talk about the running game, a two-headed monster, Bryce Anderson and Garrett Gross, they've combined for just shy of 1,000 yards on the year. Gross averages 6.5 yards per carry, Anderson at 5 yards per carry, 10 touchdowns between the two of them, only one fumble lost on the season. So can the Tigers, and maybe specifically that Wittenberg offensive line, create some holes for those guys to run through against this very, very good DePaul defense? That will be one of the big questions that needs to be answered here today. Ben Gomez is the sophomore kicker for DePaul. He handles kickoffs and punts. We'll likely see Joseph Sullivan on PATs and field goals, but it'll be Gomez who tees it up at the 35-yard line. And for the Tigers, back deep to return will be the combo of Dean Tate and Cleve Benson. Kick is away, end over end. This will be Tate from his own 5-yard line. He'll go to the middle of the field and now bounces it outside that left hash mark. Still on his feet across the 25 as a flag comes in, and Tate is tackled near the 29. So we'll wait and see what the flag is all about before this Wittenberg offense gets its first snap of the day. Tiger O-line. Wyatt Osterhage is the left tackle. Andrew McFetters is the left guard. Ed Bolden, the junior, at center, with Henry Birchwell, the sophomore right guard, and Isaac Grillo is the senior right tackle. Troy TP will be the tight end. He'll line up as a receiver quite a bit. Tyler May, Malik Bowie, Dean Tate, the starting receiving core. It's a hold against Wittenberg on the kickoff return, which will push the red and white back to their own 9-yard line, so a long field ahead for the junior QB, Max Milton.
Yeah, that's not a good start, and again, you know, the key there was it was a late flag, but, you know, you can't hold. I thought it might be a push in the back, but Wittenberg has got to be very weary of this front four and the linebackers for DePaul. They, like I said, had four sacks last week.
They will line up four across the line defensively. DePaul in their traveling white jersey tops with the black pants and black helmets. The gold D on the side. So hand it off right up the middle on first down. The guy that gets the carry is Bryce Anderson, and he'll carry out to the 11, a gain of 2. David Gold, junior, at one defensive end spot. Dominic Siebel is at the other. He's a sophomore. Ethan Lowry, the nose guard, is a senior, anchoring that DePaul defensive front.
Last time, that's the running play off Isaac Grillo, the right guard. Again, Wittenberg pushing it forward. That's the key today.
Flag flies as Milton takes the snap and hands to Anderson. Anderson is met right at the line of scrimmage. See what the headlinesman says here. He threw that flag as soon as the ball was snapped, which means DePaul may have lined up offsides. It is going to be against the defense. And so that no-gain run for Anderson will turn into, I believe, a 5-yard pickup and a replay of second down.
Offside, defense, number 21, 5-yard penalty, second down.
That's a really good penalty for Wittenberg. Again, they'll keep the second down at about 4.
That was Jake Comer, junior outside linebacker, who lined up across the line. Brevin Guide is a senior at the other outside spot. Luke Marsh and Jonathan Bruder are the juniors and middle linebackers for DePaul. The secondary, Cartez Stoudemire, a senior. Matthew Coons, a junior. Those are the corners, with Nolan Tooley, a junior safety, and Tommy Ryan is the other safety. He's a senior. And it now is second down and close to 4 here, Coach, as they'll pitch it to Anderson running left, and he'll be taken down, maybe a loss of a half of yard. It'll be third And about four to go for Wittenberg on the game's opening possession.
Yeah, that time they moved up their corner, and he was right there to meet the Wittenberg Tiger right in the hole. So this is a big third down. We'll see what happens. Wittenberg usually likes to go short outs. And, of course, Tate, Dean Tate, leads the NCAC in catches. He's the go-to guy, 8 catches a game, 14 average.
3 receivers set. They will throw, and it's going to be caught. But I believe, let's see if he's shy of the marker. It is caught by Troy Teepee.
They say first
down. Now they're waving first down. He needed to get to the 19, and that's actually where they mark him down. So a 4-yard pickup on the completion to Teepee, and Wittenberg moves the sticks.
Really good setup there. And Tigers catch a break. They got a tremendous setup on that.
I thought the DB actually hit him early before the throw got there.
And that may have been the call, Scott. That's probably what happened.
So no flag flies, though, on this one, and it'll be 1st and 10, Wittenberg, 12:43 to play in the first. Milton looking deep, man-on-man coverage. He's got Tyler May behind the defense, and May from 81 yards out will score. He ran right behind the DePaul secondary. It was Stoudemire on coverage, and May gets wide open. 81 yards and a score, and it's Wittenberg that strikes first with 12:34 to play in the first.
Max Milton drew it up, and it was just a great play. Again, Tyler May making that juke. It was one-on-one coverage. He made that juke to the right corner heading towards his bench and then flared off right across the middle. Caught it about 10 yards in front of the defender, and there was coast-to-coast all the way for a touchdown.
PAT is up and good from Brandon Goodwin. So Wittenberg catches DePaul without any safety help, and Tyler May gets past Cartez Stoudemire and catches it on the run for the big scoring play, exactly the way Wittenberg wanted to start this afternoon here in a huge NCAC matchup at home.
And that's that quick start we talked about, how important it is for Wittenberg to get the lead and then let their defense put this DePaul team and their quarterback, Nathan McCahill, into situations that he doesn't like. So we'll see. That's a great start for the Wittenberg Tigers.
So the Tigers go 91 yards in 4 plays, and they do it in only 2 minutes and 16 seconds.
Yeah,
Wittenberg with the early lead.
And Max Milton, he's 4th right now, really close to the top quarterbacks. He's 4th in the NCAC, and in front of him is McCahill. So we're going to see a nice matchup between these two players.
Kick is away from Hayden Alcott on the return from his own 7-yard line, bouncing it out. Across the 20 is the return man being tackled there. That's Tommy Ryan on the return for DePaul. So here comes this DePaul offense. Nathan McCahill, 21 touchdowns and only 2 interceptions on the year. Against a Wittenberg defense that has kind of at times been bend but don't break, with the exception of the loss to Alma, the Wittenberg defense, while they've given up some yards on Saturdays, have been able to get key stops late in closer games to seal some victories. The Denison game in overtime, Tiger defense came up big late. Here's a throw out to the left side. It'll be caught. Takes the hit and stays on his feet. Does the DePaul receiver. That's Gabe Quigley, the senior, and he'll go all the way into Wittenberg territory, finally down just across the midfield stripe. That's a 26-yard gain.
Yeah, and a lot of yak yardage there because he caught it. And showed his strength. I saw him before the game. He's a big, big kid. 4 receivers, probably the number one is Derek Allen Jr., Jalen Smith, Robbie Valentine, and Gabe Quigley. You might hear their names a lot.
Rolling right, McCahill throws, and it's incomplete. Overshoots Jalen Smith, the junior, his intended target. Receivers, Valentine, Smith. Tight end is Quigley, although a lot of times he will line up as a receiver. Gus Baumgartner is the senior running back. Caden Whitehead sees time at the tailback spot as well. Across the offensive line, Aiden Ammons and Blake Kaufman are the tackles. Tommy Martin and Bennett Smith, the juniors, and Rylan Watkins is the sophomore center. They'll get it out of the hand of the quarterback quickly here behind the line of scrimmage as DePaul goes with a wide receiver screen play, getting it back to Quigley, and he's knocked off his feet at the 44, a gain of 6. Here comes third down and 4, the first big third down play of the day for DePaul.
Tigers do a nice job of tackling. This game is going to be about tackling and tackling in space, and a very good tackle by Wittenberg there. This is the first test right here.
DePaul has converted on 46% of the third downs this year. They go to the air. It's caught near the first down marker, and it is going to be a first down at the 40-yard line. Catch was made by Ballantyne, the sophomore, 6'1", 200-pounder, immediately hit and stopped by the Tigers' senior linebacker, Dane Flatter.
Yeah, that was just a quick curl on the outside. He used his body well like a basketball player and got the chance in front of the defender for a first down.
McCahill will line up in the gun with a running back behind him. Tiger defense, Wittenberg's defense, Nick Wadsworth, Nathan Pratt, Connor Walls, the three up front. With Pratt in the middle, the senior, down in a four-point stance. They'll hand it off, and right up the middle goes Whitehead. He'll carry to the 38, a gain of a pair, staying between the tackles. And it's second down and 8. Tiger linebackers, Eli Rennick, the sophomore, Mario Gitaw, the junior, Cam Snur, the junior, and senior Dane Flatter, who we've already mentioned on a tackle here today.
Yeah, we need to hear from the linebackers a lot today, and this is a situation right here where you want to force them into a third and long. So we'll see what happens.
They'll go to the air near sideline. The catch is made at the 31. Taken down immediately is Jalen Smith, the receiver. On coverage for Wittenberg was Max Yost in at a cornerback spot. Darian Williams and Jordan Stipe are the typical starting corners. Yost in there at the moment. Anthony Pedro is a senior safety, and so is Christian Sweet. 9:55 to play in the first. DePaul looking at a third and one. They'll hand it off right up the middle. Whitehead, he's hit immediately and pushed back, but he did get just across the line of scrimmage. Forward progress will give him the first down at the 29. First and 10, DePaul. With 9:42 to play, clock rolling here in the first quarter, DePaul is on the move after Wittenberg went 91 yards in just 4 plays on their first possession today.
Yeah, the running backs for DePaul, Gus Baumgartner, he's going to be the main guy, and then Caden Whitehead's going to come up and make plays too.
That Wittenberg scoring drive took just 2 minutes and 16 seconds. Now DePaul trying to answer back. They'll get it into the hands of Quigley. On a carry, the end around to the near side, Quigley down to the 26. That's a gain of 3. It'll bring up second down and 7. Clock goes under 9 minutes to play in the first.
Good play, good follow-up by Tyree Smith. He's the leading tackler for Wittenberg, linebacker. He can make plays. He's going to be very busy today out of Sarasota, Florida.
Here's the shotgun snap to McCahill, hands it off, and on the carry, this is Tommy Ryan, the senior. He'll carry to the 24. Actually, they say Cooper Simons Little is the guy that carried that ball wearing number 2. So a uniform change from what we have on the roster for DePaul. Simons Little checks out, and Whitehead back in now. It's third down and 4, DePaul. Third and 4, ball on the right hash mark at the Wittenberg 24 as the clock goes under 8 minutes left in the first quarter. Scott Leo and the coach Jim Scobie with you. McCahill gets the snap, throws, and it's intercepted. Jumping the route near the DePaul sideline and picking it off is Darian Williams. Williams, 2 weeks ago, had a surefire pick 6, and he dropped it. He doesn't make that mistake here today. He jumps in front of the DePaul receiver, takes it away, And the Wittenberg Red Swarm defense bends but doesn't break.
Darian Williams again showed you his quickness. He was really, really close to the offensive player. They tried that quick out that's been successful so far. Darian read it perfectly, got the interception, and if it hadn't been a late tackle, he'd have probably gone for that pick six. Wittenberg, again, gets a turnover. Turnovers are so big in games like this, and we'll see if Wittenberg now can make him pay.
So Max Milton will line up in the gun here on first and 10. He's throwing near sideline. Leaping catch is made by the Tigers receiver Dean Tate. And the senior Tate is taken down at the DePaul 49. It's a first down Wittenberg, and they're in DePaul territory with 7:35 to play here in this opening quarter. Two receivers left. Garrett Gross is the running back. We've got whistles, we've got flags, and we've got a false start against Wittenberg. So that'll back them up 5 yards to the other side of midfield. It'll be first and 15 from Wittenberg's own 46.
72, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Guilty party on that one, Coach Scobie, was Ed Bolden, the junior, the center, got called for the false start.
6'1", 280, and he
flinched the football, maybe?
He knew right away, just jumped right away. He's pretty geeked up right now.
Here's a handoff to Gross, and he'll get back to the line, and that's it. Met pretty quickly. And for DePaul on the stop was Jake Comer, Luke Marsh there as well. It'll be second down and 15.
Tigers have done a nice job, and they're looking to run the football, but their passing attack has been exceptional. Two really long passes. That last one that they threw to Tate, they went straight down the field. It looked like they may run the same play that scored the touchdown. Tate then kind of filtered off to the right, and the ball was right on his numbers.
6:41 to play in the first. Two receivers out to the right. Wide side of the field is open here. They'll hand it off, and Garrett Gross lowers those shoulder pads and muscles forward to the 49. He'll pick up 3 yards. It'll put Wittenberg in a third and 11. Third down has been a point of emphasis for this Wittenberg team this year because, to be honest, at times they haven't been very good converting them, but a chance here near midfield to keep this drive alive with an early 7-0 lead.
The key here, and it's been key already in this game, is make sure you protect your quarterback, Max Milton. This is where DePaul loves to come after the quarterback.
Milton looking upfield, looking, and now lets it fly, and this is going to be broken up. Tried to go underneath, well short of the first down marker anyway. Troy Teepee was the target. And Wittenberg will have to punt on fourth and long.
Yeah, that's probably a good throw in the sense that that was a ball that could be picked off. It was thrown late, and it was thrown into the flat. A very long pass, which gave the defender lots of time. So Wittenberg might have been fortunate on that one. They're going to punt it away.
DePaul is coming after it,
nice.
And the kick is away. Back inside the 10-yard line, it is caught by Whitehead for the return, and he doesn't get very far. He gets to the 10, and that's it. A very good punt for Wittenberg's Hayden Alcott.
Got a flag right now.
Alcott, only a sophomore, the punter. Yeah, we do have a flag after the play. There's an injured DePaul player.
Well, you hope this is not something that Wittenberg has said, made a comment or said something that gets him DePaul out of this.
I think it's on DePaul, but it might be an unsportsmanlike. I didn't see anything happen at the end of that play that seemed out of the ordinary, but from up here, there's no way to know what's being said down there, so that's a whole different animal. Let's see what the flag is about. Tigers, Wittenberg indicating it's against DePaul.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness.
Ooh.
Kicking team, number 5, 15-yard penalty.
It is against Wittenberg.
I didn't see see that, but again, gosh, a situation where Wittenberg had them back on their heels, right around the 10-yard line, and they end up giving it a movement up so that they can have a better chance. You want to bottle them up right here. This would be a great time. They flip the field, The defense right now needs to get it back.
15 yards gives DePaul the football at their own 25-yard line. 5:46 to play in the first. McKay Hill threw only his third interception of the year on that first drive. They'll hand it to Whitehead up the middle and out across the 30 to the 31. Caden Whitehead, the 5'11", 180-pound sophomore running back. Gain of 6, second down and 4.
Yeah, he's showing a little bit of juice right now. He's got a little get up and go, and he's shown a couple runs where he made it happen.
They'll hand it to Whitehead again. This time he is brought down at the line of scrimmage. Coming through from the backside to make that stop was Trey Brenninger. The freshman, Brenninger, was able to shed a blocker and then lunges at the legs of Whitehead to stop him at the 31-yard line. Here comes 3rd and 4.
Great quickness, great speed. It's Tiger up time, and these fans are into it. Wittenberg's team is up, jumping around. This is what it's about right here. You really want to come after them. You want to make this a special play, and fans are into it.
And it'll be a little play action. McCahill steps up, tries to escape, still being chased, needs to get to the 35, and he will. Gets the first down. It looked like McCahill was going to be dead to rights for a sack behind the line of scrimmage, but he's able to sneak away, and he picks up 8 yards to keep the drive alive. Nice play by the junior quarterback.
Yeah, that was a fortunate play for DePaul because where they were at, he showed some moxie there. He was able to get away from a couple defenders, and as you said, it looked like one of the Tigers got a bear claw on him, but he was able to skip out of it and gain 8 yards for the first down.
We're going to go under 4 minutes left to play in the first with DePaul trying to get something started here on their second possession of the game. A handoff to Whitehead. He's met right at the line of scrimmage. He'll be brought down, pulled down at the 40, so he does get a yard. Second down and 9. Elsewhere around the NCAC today, Wabash playing at Kenyon, Oberlin at Hiram, and coming up in about 35 minutes, it's Worcester at Denison. But there's no question, the big game of the day in the conference is this one, the two remaining unbeatens in conference play going head-to-head in the rain here in Springfield. McCahill gets the snap, a little counter on the handoff coming back to the near side, and this is a pickup of a first down to the Wittenberg 49. Cooper Simmons Little is actually listed as a quarterback on our original roster. He gets the carry and picks up the first down. So DePaul has it in Wittenberg territory with 3:09 and counting to play in the first.
Yeah, another one of those plays to Connor Sims and really fooled Wittenberg there.
McCahill wants to go deep down the left side, and he overthrows his receiver. Jalen Smith had room to operate. He had beaten Anthony Pedro, the senior, by a few steps. It's incomplete. Second down.
Yeah, that was really an opportunity for DePaul to maybe get another 7 here and tie this thing up, but Tigers fortunate on that play. Wittenberg would like to come in here now and put a little pressure. They've got to be ready to get a hold of the runner, make sure that they can make a tackle, and they do.
Yep, McCahill able to get it out into the flats for Quigley. He'll be taken down at the Wittenberg 42, a gain of 7. Here comes 3rd down. McCahill is 5 for 8 for 50 yards, 1 interception so far.
One thing I like about McCahill, he throws to a lot of different receivers. He doesn't focus on just one. You just have to be aware of his ability to find that 1, 2, 3, or 4 decisions on each play.
From the gun on 3rd and 3 from the 42. Hand off Whitehead, trying to bounce it out to the right side. He does. First down, knocked off his feet near the Tiger 36. It's a gain of 6, make it a gain of 7 yards to the 35. Gabe Quigley is the leading pass catcher for DePaul. 3 catches, 39 yards today. Smith and Ballantyne each have 1 reception. And for Caden Whitehead, that's his 6th carry of the day, totaling 18 yards.
This is a situation where Wittenberg would love to get a big hit, get a play where they can turn this thing around. They don't want to let this team get grounded.
Cahill to throw, right sideline. He throws it behind Whitehead. But Whitehead was covered up pretty well on that sideline route. Tigers had Anthony Pedro over there. And also another defender giving chase. So it'll be second down and 10. Ball on the right hash mark. DePaul on the move for the second straight drive. The last time they got into Wittenberg territory, the drive ended with an interception. Second and 10. Cahill will throw again, and it's broken up.
Hit.
Big hit applied on a pass intended for Jalen Smith. And the guy that introduced himself was Max Yost.
Good play by Yost. He read the play correctly and absolutely laid out the DePaul player. And those are the kind of hits that can really fire up a football team. And now Wittenberg, certainly DePaul in a passing down.
Third and 10 from the 35 with 99 seconds left in the first quarter. McCahill with a running back to his right. Motion man Quigley goes left. Three receivers out to the left side. McCahill to throw. Pressure coming. Fires. And it's caught down at the 21-yard line. Still on his feet. Cutting back to the sideline. Going up the sideline and into the end zone is Robbie Ballantyne for the DePaul touchdown. From 35 yards out, it is McCahill to Ballantyne, and DePaul is an extra point away from tying the game.
Yeah, Wittenberg came with a full blitz. They sent the house, and they got that one-on-one coverage out there. Ballantyne had a little room, caught it, then made some jukes, and once he made that play down the sideline, he just took it from there, touchdown.
So here comes the PAT. We mentioned Joseph Sullivan does the extra points and field goals, and he will kick this one up and through. Out of the hold of Daniel Tippett. So with 1:29 remaining in the first, we're back to even. Wittenberg 7 and DePaul 7. And Coach Scobie, the Wittenberg defense on that drive again had a couple of chances to get off the field but couldn't stop DePaul on third downs. And so that'll be something to watch going forward. Can they get that drive-ending stop and force DePaul's offense to give up the football?
Well, it was interesting because they dialed up pressure, and you almost wonder at that place. It was really two-down territory for this DePaul team. So you almost wonder, you know, maybe if you just play reasonable and just get some guys in space, then they're not going to have that freedom, that one-on-one situation. You've got to be careful when you put a guy out on an island, and that's what happened with Wittenberg on that play. And the game's tied up 7-7.
So here is Ben Gomez to kick off for DePaul. Ball teed up at the 35-yard line. Back deep for the Tigers. It's Tate and Benson. And this one will get into the end zone a couple yards deep for a touchback. I want to thank our sponsors here on the Tiger Sports Network, Union Capital Mortgage, Raising Cane's, Buffalo Wild Wings, as well as Stanley Steamer. We're celebrating 100 years here at the stadium, Wittenberg Stadium, Edwards-Mauer Field. First game played 100 years ago yesterday, October 20th, 1923. A lot of history here in this venue, and it's taken on some different looks over the years, but
a neat milestone. When I was here, it was a tremendous game. I remember it was a beautiful sunny day.
For that game in 1923?
23.
Were you a sophomore that year?
Freshman.
Okay. Hand off to Bryce Anderson right up the middle into the second level of the DePaul defense.
Nice.
He's got the first down and then some.
Said he fumbled.
Taken down at the 41. DePaul's trying to say they took the ball from him, but we'll see what the officials say. They say he was down, I believe. Yep. Anderson was on the turf first. And so it will be a 15-yard carry for Bryce Anderson and a first down.
Ruling on the field, the runner was down, the ball came loose.
Well, that's thank you.
So it's hard to tell when the whistle was blown, but the back judge is the one that came in and made the call. He would have had a pretty good look at it from where he is set up to where the stop was made. And I don't know if Wittenberg caught a break there or not, but they've got a first down.
It doesn't have to be that he fell on the ground. You know, it could be when he was held up, and that's a decision the officials make.
Here's Milton to throw. Pressure coming, and he's going to throw it away.
Smart.
Throws it at the feet of Bryce Anderson. It'll be incomplete. It'll be second and 10. Now, Anderson, by the way, prior to the potential fumble at the end of the play, that's as hard as we've seen him run so far. He was able to bounce himself off of three different DePaul tacklers, gaining 15 yards. If Wittenberg can have some success in the running game like that, it should open things up.
Yeah, Anderson's a bruiser. He averages about 5 per carry. He's got the most touchdowns rushing of 8. But that time, just a smart play by Max Milton shows you how much he's developed that he just threw that away. He could have tried to make a play.
Pressure coming. Milton's going to dump it to Anderson. Caught it behind the line of scrimmage, and he'll be thrown down near the 44. It's a gain of 3 yards. It'll be third down and 7 for Wittenberg with under a minute to play here in this opening quarter. We're talking about the 100 years of the stadium. They did a little bit last week in remembering the history of this facility, and that first game, October 20th of 1923, was against Ohio Wesleyan.
Isn't that something? And
Tigers' most frequently played opponent.
And what was the, you know, how many people showed up that day? It's some amazing.
It was a good turnout. Was it 5,000 plus? Here's
something
a deep
like
ball
that
for Tyler May. Under three, but May waits on it and makes the catch inside the 30. He's tackled at the 22. Wittenberg goes back to the air and gets 34 yards, finding the same guy that had the touchdown catch earlier in this quarter. So the first big play of the day and the last big play of the first quarter are both Max Milton to Tyler May. And we are 15 minutes in here in Springfield in a battle of NCAC unbeatens. It's Wittenberg 7 and DePaul 7 on the Tiger Sports Network. One quarter in the books alongside the coach, Jim Scobie. Scott Leo with you here in Springfield. Tigers and Tigers, Wittenberg and DePaul in a big one in the NCAC. The winner will grab sole possession of first place. Wittenberg just hit on a 34-yard pass completion. Milton to Tyler May. So that sets the red and white up at the DePaul 22-yard line. Ball on the right hash mark, first down and 10. Anderson in the backfield. Milton to throw. Fires, and it's going to be Dean Tate. He was able to get away from the defender, and he'll get to the 2. That is a 20-yard completion, and that was a double move by Tate. I was watching him on that far sideline. It was an out route that then turned in to a go route, and Milton did a great job of looking the defense off, and then he threw an absolute bullet. Wittenberg is in business now, first and goal from the 2.
Yeah, you know, Scott, you're the boss. I mean, it's called Scott the Boss Leo, and you have made some great calls over the years, but this is the type of game that we talk about a lot, that this is, you're seeing the Wittenberg Tigers raise their level today, and they've seen something on the right side, they've attacked it, but that play there was exceptional. Of course, a DePaul player down right where that catch was. Looks like he's going to be okay, which is good. But
we've seen, I mean, part of that, you know, you talk about making some great calls. We have seen so many big games over the years, and I have. And it's fun to have one of those here today. After a tough year last year, Jim Collins and his staff coming in first year at a place where you just don't get very many coaching changes. And so for Wittenberg to be playing in this type of game in late October, that's exciting, I know, for this Wittenberg football family. And they're going to try and get the lead here as they hand it to Bryce Anderson from the two, and he will bounce his way into the end zone. Bryce Anderson, a two-yard carry on his fourth touch of the afternoon. It is his seventh touchdown of the season, 14:38 to play in the second. Wittenberg 13, DePaul 7.
Yeah, just a great play. He read that. Looked like he was going to go inside, but he saw a hole on the right side and took it onto the end zone. Barely got touched.
So here comes the PAT from Brandon Goodwin. It is up, and it is through. 14-7, Wittenberg. Looking back at the history of the series between these two, we mentioned that Wittenberg has won 12 of the 16 meetings. Wittenberg has won 5 of the last 6. But 2 years ago, DePaul came here and beat Wittenberg on homecoming. It was a 17-14 game. That's the last time they played here in Springfield. When DePaul joined the North Coast Athletic Conference, which for football would have been the 2012 season, their first conference game was here in Springfield against Wittenberg, and there was a lot of talk about how this DePaul program was going to be able to compete year in, year out, just like Wittenberg and Wabash had done for conference championships, and it didn't really start that way for DePaul.
They were going
through some transitions of their own in the football program, and Wittenberg beat them in that first ever matchup as NCAC foes 52-14. It was a night game, and I remember it pretty vividly. It led to a pretty immediate coaching change at DePaul, actually, after they took a beating that night.
Welcome to Springfield.
Yep, kick is away, and it's into the end zone. This will be a touchback, and so the DePaul offense will have it with 14:38 to play in the second quarter, and Wittenberg leading 14-7. DePaul, of course, still has a really big one at the end of the year against Wabash, and Wittenberg sees Wabash next week over in Crawfordsville. So while this game is for sole possession of first place, both of these squads have some big football games ahead.
Absolutely, Scott. And this game here is at a place here with about 14:30 before halftime that Tigers really have got to show themselves, get gritty here, and stop this offense of DePaul. Last time they had it, they grinded it all the way and then had that long pass.
They screened it out here to Whitehead, and he's going to get out to the 33. So that's a first down pickup of 8 yards.
And you cannot give up on first down like 7 and 8 and 9 because now this is a down where you can do a lot of different things with it. You can take a shot right now.
Three receivers, two to the left. McCahill gets the snap, hands it off. And back to the line of scrimmage is Whitehead, and nothing more. He is met by the interior of that Wittenberg defensive line. And the first guy to put a hat on him was Eli Rennick. Tony Calavini was also there coming up off the bottom of the pile.
This is where you got to Tiger up. These fans have got to get into it. This is that third down situation, Scott, you've talked about. What a perfect time to bring something out to beat, you know, your blocker and make a play. This is huge.
Third down and 2 from the 33. McCahill quickly fires it out to the left, and it's incomplete. It's right through the hands of Gabe Quigley. And it'll be fourth down, and here comes the punt team for DePaul.
Gabe Quigley, the senior, usually sure-handed.
Mm-hmm.
He had it wide open, and I think he looked the wrong way. He looked to run it, and that's the worst thing you can do. It went right through his hands, and Wittenberg will get the ball back. This is huge because after, you know, what they did in that last possessions, this is key. Perfect time for Wittenberg to get it going again.
Ben Gomez is back to punt from his own 19-yard line. Good snap. Kick is away. Wittenberg was coming after it. And this is going to chase Tyler May back to the 10, and then it's going to bounce and go into the end zone. So
that's
Wittenberg
amazing.
lucks out because Gomez absolutely crushed it.
It's almost 70 yards.
And Wittenberg will get a chance to bring it out and have a little breathing room from their own 20-yard line with 13-11 left to play here in the second quarter. So far, when you look at the way this game has played out statistically, total offense is 177 for Wittenberg, 135 for DePaul. But here's the stat that stands out. DePaul is averaging 5.5 yards per play. Wittenberg's averaging 12.5 yards per play because of a couple of big scoring strikes, big passing plays, I should say, one of them for a score, both to Tyler May. Garrett Gross gets the handoff on first down. He'll be met, trying to run behind the right side of that Tiger O line. Maybe picks up a yard. He will get one to the 21.
Tigers right now may need to expand their offensive book a little bit and see what they can do and get some yardage, get a first down, get the thing rhythm going.
Two receivers out to the left. Gross, the running back, to the left of Milton. Milton to throw. Deep, and here comes a flag. Dean Tate was manhandled in front of the Wittenberg sideline.
Don't say anything.
So Tate put a move on the DePaul defensive back, which is Stoudemire, and, I mean, Dean Tate was going to have him beat from here to there, and so Stoudemire just grabbed a hold.
Yep.
Just grabbed a hold and held on for dear life. And it's actually a smart play by Stoudemire because that's 6 points if he doesn't commit pass interference. And so Tate, who had a double move on the last drive.
Yes. 15-yard penalty. Big play. Big play.
Had a big a double move on the last drive that led to a 20-yard strike. Did the same thing in reverse. He came cut back inward away from the sideline, and Stoudemire was stuck. All he could do was grab on.
I'm going to tell you, Dean Tate has got some speed, and he has got quickness, and you have to give him some room because if he catches it, he knows what to do
with
it.
He's so hard to cover, especially if he gets one-on-one coverage.
It's his.
We haven't found anybody yet that can really slow him down.
No.
Here's a handoff to Gross. And Gross goes right up the middle to the 39. It'll be a pickup of 3. Just his quickness off the line of scrimmage, Dean Tate, makes it so tough to keep him from getting open. And if Milton can find him, that's been a lethal combination this year for the Wittenberg offense.
This is a situation, again, where you want to get into that mode of grinding it. But when you get your chance, take that quick out, that quick pass to get a first down.
Little play action. Here's Milton throwing over the middle for Tyler May. He's got the first down. He'll be wrestled down at the 47, a pickup of 8 yards. So Wittenberg moves the sticks with 11:45 to play. Second quarter here in Springfield, Wittenberg and DePaul.
That time they had two guys on Dean Tate, and he looked that way, and I thought, oh, no, don't throw it there. And then he looked back and caught it right along the seam, and a big first down. Keep rolling, baby.
Rain continues to fall here at Edwards Mauer Field. Milton, play action again, throws. This will be Tate, caught it first down. Dean Tate comes back to the football and hauls it in at the 42. That'll be a gain of 11. And so Max Milton kind of has the hot hand here now. He's making some throws. The Tiger junior quarterback is 8 of 11 on the day.
Well, you mentioned, too, with the rain coming, it really helps an offensive player, especially wide receiver, with his footwork.
Give to Gross. Bounces it out right side. Gets toppled inside the 40. He's down to the 37. A pickup of 5 yards. And this is where, for the Wittenberg offense, we've seen this several times this year. It gets going to the where you kind of feel like they're rolling downhill because the running game starts churning out bigger yardage on early downs. Milton is making all the throws. The receivers are getting open. They're protecting the quarterback up front. We'll see if Wittenberg can sustain that against a very good DePaul defense. It's It's really just been a matter of consistency for Wittenberg, doing that on a regular basis this year.
Yeah, and I think that touchdown, that long touchdown, really helps because it frees up some guys.
Here's one that's dumped off to Troy Teepe, who bobbled it all the way to the sideline. He does hold on to it, but really no gain as he makes the catch just in time to be knocked off his feet by Luke Marsh, the linebacker.
Yeah, and this could be two-down territory. Max Milton's got to be very careful here because this is a situation where if you're DePaul, you're going to try maybe to, as a defender, to jump the route. And this is one place where you don't want to try to force anything.
Third down and 5 from the 37. Give to Gross. He is still up. He got spun around.
First down.
Was able to, with a second effort, pick up the first down.
Yes.
He was laying on the defender, and we've seen that before in college football. The knee's not down. He's able to spin off that defender and keep running. And the Tigers move the sticks at the DePaul 32.
And I'll tell you who made that play work was Max Milton. He held on to it almost as if he was going to run it, and then he handed it off. That was a very smart play.
So first and 10, Tigers. That's a big pickup on third down. Wittenberg is 4 of 5 on third downs today. Under 9 minutes left to play in the half. Milton steps up, throws, and coming back to the football, making the catch is Malik Bowe. He's down to the 26. That's a 6-yard gain.
And again, Scott, they are so concerned about number 11 because they know that he is such a threat, or I should say 13 because he's such a sweat, such a difficult player, and that's Tyler May.
Reed Hall is in the game. They'll hand it to Hall right up the middle, the third Tiger running back on the depth chart, and he muscles his way down to the 23.
And a DePaul player had to run off the field, and he's limping.
Third and 1 coming up. Tyler May's deep threat, and then the difficulty that defenses have in stopping Dean Tate from getting open. Tate's
Absolutely.
Usually short to medium range type of routes. Gives some layers to this Tiger passing game. Third and 1, big play here. Milton hands to Gross, bounces it out, has plenty of room. First down and all the way down to the DePaul 17. It's a 6-yard gain. The Wittenberg offense getting it done here on this drive with 7:53 left until halftime.
What a great block on the right side for this offense. Again, Isaac Grillo, Angel Bravo, those guys just blew the everybody to the inside, and it freed up the running back on the right side. Good gain. Good first down.
Hand off to Gross. Cuts it back inside the hash mark at the 23. Or I should say at the 17, and then falls forward down to the 14.
And this, Scott, is where Wittenberg, it seems, has had difficulty in the red zone. Third downs and red zone situations have been tough. And so this would be a huge boost of confidence to get a touchdown right here and go in at halftime with their defense stopping DePaul.
Hits 7 minutes left in the quarter. Milton's going to throw to the end zone for Tyler May, and it's incomplete. Trying to hit him about 5 yards deep in the end zone. May was covered by Luke Marsh on that out route. It'll be 3rd and 7.
And again, that's a tough pass for Milton to throw to the corner like that across the field. You're looking for something a little shorter. You got to gain this first down.
So Milton lines him up. 4 receivers set, 2 to each side. Teepee is lined up in the backfield. They'll throw the bubble screen for Dean Tate, and he gets back to the line of scrimmage, and that is it. Let's see what the Tigers head coach Jim Collins wants to do. He's going to send the kicking team out to attempt a field goal down at the north end zone with 6.5 to go in the second. Wittenberg leading 14-7. This would be a 31-yard attempt. Tigers haven't kicked many of them this year. This is a rare opportunity for Brandon Goodwin from that left hash mark. Snap back, hold down. Kick is away, and it is good. Perfect from 31 yards out. Brandon Goodwin will give Wittenberg a 17-7 lead with 6:09 to go, quarter two here in Springfield. Not a bad drive at all for Wittenberg's offense coach. They really were able to balance that run and pass. Only come away with three, but Wittenberg showing they can move the ball against this tough DePaul D.
Yeah, they have, and I think, you know, getting that three will certainly help. You don't want to leave this area without points, and certainly Wittenberg got that. Still wanting to see Wittenberg, when you get down in that area, you've got to score touchdowns, especially in a game like this. If you want to win it, you threes won't do it. You got to score touchdowns. So this next 6 minutes will be key. Tigers need to just really bow their backs and make some plays here. Keep DePaul off the board.
So that's the second made field goal for Brandon Goodwin this year. He's 2 for 4 on the year. That's his long, by the way, that 31-yarder. The other one was 27. Kick is away, and on the return out across the 30 goes Cooper Simmons-Little. He's knocked off his feet at the 36. So good starting field position here for DePaul. There's still over 6 minutes to play until halftime. I'll mark it down at the 37-yard line, actually. So the DePaul quarterback, Nathan McCahill, is 7 of 13, 93 yards, one touchdown, one pick. Caden Whitehead, the leading rusher, 7 carries for 18 yards, averaging 2.5 yards per carry. Pressure coming. McCahill looking to escape. Rolling left. A flag comes in. Looks like a holding call probably. And McCahill will simply throw it out of bounds because he wasn't going to make it out of bounds, running away from the Tiger defenders. But I think this is going to back DePaul up on a hold call.
Holding.
Yep.
Offense.
Good call, Scott.
75. 10-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
Wittenberg's defensive front coach doing a tremendous job early in this game of getting some pressure on McCahill and making that DePaul offensive line really work.
Well, and not just that, Scott, their ability, I think whether they have 17 yards rushing, that's critical because you force McCahill and DePaul to be one-dimensional. And when you're one-dimensional on a day like today, it can bite you. And, of course, the rain and everything, so things are going really, really well for Wittenberg. They just got to continue to be smart.
Whitehead on the carry here out of bounds at the 32.
You've got to keep people in front of you. Can't let them get behind you right now.
Gain of 5, second down and 15 coming up for DePaul. As Wittenberg tries to hold this 10-point lead into the locker room. McCahill will have Whitehead stationed behind him as the junior QB works from the shotgun. Gets the snap, looks, fires, it's batted up in the air, and it'll be incomplete. Boy, not only did Nathan Pratt deflect that ball up in the air, but then Pratt went chasing after it, and I thought for a second the senior defensive tackle was going to go and catch it.
I do, too.
And third and 15.
DePaul thought the same thing, and they were running for it because they thought that Wittenberg would get an interception, pick six. Here's the entire game we talk about it. Third downs, so critical.
McCahill looking to throw. Here comes pressure. Throws deep up the left side, and it's going to be caught to the back shoulder. That's an excellent throw to Jalen Smith. Smith brings it in and is knocked out of bounds at the Wittenberg 25. That's a 43-yard pitch and catch. McCahill right on the money to the back shoulder where only Smith could make the catch.
That's a highlight right there. That's one of those plays that only comes around once in a while. And how about McCahill throwing it to the back of his receiver? Just a perfect play.
And McCahill goes to the air again here, completes it, and it's a touchdown. Wow. That's Gabe Quigley from 25 yards out. Two good throws from McCahill. And just like that, DePaul finds pay dirt And it's Wittenberg 17, DePaul 13, with 4:52 remaining in the second.
Yeah, remember that possession. They had them down third and 15, that long bomb from McCahill, and then a really long pass for the touchdown. Again, this was very similar to DePaul's first touchdown, which they made a couple long passes that kind of broke Wittenberg's back. So that's a shocker right there, the way they moved the football down the field.
Here comes the PAT. It is low, but it is through. Kick is good from Joseph Sullivan. And it's 17-14, Wittenberg with a three-point lead. 4:52 remaining, second quarter here at Edwards-Mauer Field. Final score from the NCAC, Wabash beats Kenyon 67-18. Oberlin playing at Hiram today as well. That game is just starting the fourth quarter, and Hiram leads Oberlin 20-10. They're just getting ready to kick off at Denison. Worcester at Denison this afternoon from over in Granville at Deeds Piper.
That's a Denison team that, you know, they've got two losses right now, but they're very, very good. They have the best running back in the league. And, you know, some guys that last year really knew how to win. And that's got to be tough for them. And it says a lot about Wittenberg going over there and getting a big win, setting up this huge game against DePaul.
Yeah, DePaul's 5-0 in the conference. Wittenberg is 4-0. Wabash 4-1. Denison and Ohio Wesleyan each 3-2. That's how the top half of the conference looks, with a few weeks still to go. On the return, bouncing it out to the right side. Good return here from Wittenberg's Elijah Salat. That was Salat on the return. Out to the 30-yard line. 4:46 to go until the break.
If you're Wittenberg, go back to what's been working. Grind it. Look for those opportunities on the perimeter. You just really want to move the football. And again, it's going to be one of those games where you're going to have to just try to move the ball and hold on to the ball. You saw what DePaul's done a couple times. Just within a couple minutes, they've scored. So it's something that they've got to iron out defensively. But offensively, the Tigers have really been sound.
Tigers are going to call a timeout. Max Milton called the timeout. They weren't going to get the playoff in time, but I think Jim Collins is asking if the play clock should have been reset from where it was. Wittenberg didn't feel like they had as much time as they thought they should have there, so they burned a timeout before the first play of this drive. So 17-14, Wittenberg with the lead. Max Milton is 11 of 15 for 179 yards, one touchdown, no interceptions. Garrett Gross has rushed it 8 times for 26 yards. Bryce Anderson, 4 carries, 20 yards. Reed Hall has 1 carry for 3 yards. Tyler May has been the big pass catcher for Wittenberg today. 123 yards on 3 catches, including an 81-yard touchdown reception. Dean Tate has 4 carries for 44. Malik Bowe has 1 carry for 6, or 1 catch for 6. Troy Teepee, 2 receptions for 3 yards. Whistles. False start on Wittenberg.
Yep. Not a good way to start. But you got to like this game, this scenario. It's 50 degrees. It's Wittenberg football. They're playing old-fashioned football, pounding it, doing the things they're supposed to do. This is what Wittenberg Tiger people love to see.
Here's a handoff for Garrett Gross, and he tried to bounce it out to the left and was met, and he's taken down for a loss of 2. Actually, that was Reed Hall on the carry.
And you can see where DePaul, the momentum has really turned up on their side. That's a big defensive play, second and extremely long. This is a situation again where you've got to be careful. Can't
second down
mistakes.
And 17 to go here from Wittenberg zone 23. 4:14 to play in the second.
DePaul's had four sacks in the last game.
Milton has two receivers to his left. Steps up in the pocket, throws, but he was hit as he threw, and it's incomplete, looking for Malik Bowe. But Milton couldn't get it to him because he was hit right as he stepped into that throw. So it'll be third and 17.
Yeah, we talked about sacks before. Comer and Guide and Nolan had sacks last week, and David Gould and Dominic Siebel, they each had a half a sack. So they're gonna come after him.
Four receiver look. Milton looking upfield. Now escapes the pocket to the left, fires to Bowe, well short of the first down. He'll be tackled at the 27, and Wittenberg will punt. It is a pickup of 4 yards with 3:48 left until the break, and DePaul's going to get it back with a chance to tie or even take the lead before half.
You know, we talk about turnovers a lot, Scott, but penalties can really hurt you. That particular possession, the penalty just killed them, and now they've got another penalty. You wonder who's this again? It's back in Wittenberg's vicinity.
Delay of game.
Warning. Wittenberg gets their first of the game. Fourth down.
Delay of game warning.
Oh, okay.
Not sure if...
That's unusual. Never heard of that.
Not sure if that was...
Looks like DePaul's coming. They've got everybody up there.
I think they might be bringing a bunch here. Yeah, you're right, Coach. So the snap is back and kick is away.
Oh, what a kick.
Alcott had a great punt earlier, and here's another one. It's going to be down to... near the DePaul 30-yard line. So that is where they'll mark it. 43 yards on the kick. No return, and DePaul goes to work with 3:27 remaining in the first half of play. Wittenberg scored on their first drive of this game. They went 91 yards in just four plays as Milton hit Tyler May on an 81-yard strike. DePaul answered back late in the first quarter. McCahill to Ballantyne from 35 yards away. Wittenberg in the second quarter got a 2-yard Bryce Anderson run to cap off a 75-yard drive, followed by a Brandon Goodwin field goal to go up 17-7. And then DePaul scored with 4:52 remaining on a McCahill 25-yard strike to Gabe Quigley. 4-play, 63-yard drive that took just 73 seconds, and that's how DePaul got back within three. And now DePaul with the football again, and Whitehead carries for 3 yards on first down.
You know, you get the sense, Scott, that this is one of those games that could end up, you know, the last team that has it wins it. And this is both teams are going to – it's a physical game, so you got to withstand it and fight through it and be the last man standing. So this is physical football right now.
McCahill screens it out to Whitehead. He's across the 40, first down. And he's down at the 45, 12-yard gain on the short pass from McCahill to Caden Whitehead.
Again, DePaul with a lot of these large gains, whether it's passing or running, and that's been the thing this second quarter is allowing DePaul to get these big gashes.
Tigers bringing extras here. McCahill to throw. His arm got hit as he threw it. It's up for grabs and intercepted. The Tigers pick it off on a ball that got hung in the air longer than he wanted. McCahill throws his second interception of the game, and Jordan Stipe will return it to the house.
Wow.
Stipe will take it to the end zone. A pick six for the Wittenberg defense, and the red and white will go ahead 23-14 with 2:09 left in the second quarter.
What made that special is the front five for Wittenberg broke through and hit McCahill just as he released it, and so the ball hung up a little bit, allowing Wittenberg to catch it and go all the way.
Jordan Stipe able to just in a jump ball go up and rip it away from the DePaul receiver. And then he got some blocking downfield.
Yep, yards after the catch.
Avoided
man.
Some tacklers, and that's a pick six for the Wittenberg defense.
That's huge. And that's something Wittenberg's been able to do in this game is force some turnovers.
Brandon Goodwin on the PAT. It is up. It is good. So the Wittenberg defense comes up large. 24-14. Yeah, you're right, Coach. Give credit to the guys up front. They were able to get to McCahill and got to his arm, hit his arm as he threw it, looked like, and so that ball kind of fluttered a little bit on him. Stipe was providing great coverage, recognized the ball, and was able to get his shoulders turned and basically, like in basketball, had position for the rebound. He went up and took it away from the DePaul
Used
receiver and goes the distance on the return.
You know, that play, Scott, was similar to the ball that was thrown on the last long drive by DePaul. Remember when McCahill threw it up and the receiver came back to it? He tried the same thing that time, and because of the pressure, it got him. So 2:09 to go, Tigers 24-14. And, again, you cannot let this DePaul team get any quick plays, long bombs, anything that could give them any points. You want to hold them out of the end zone.
Alcott's kick. It'll be returned from the 3-yard line right up the middle across the 35 to the 40. Great return here from Simmons Little. He spun down at the 44. So DePaul's had some nice kick returns
really
that have
has.
Set their offense up pretty nicely here today. We've got exactly 2 minutes to go in the second quarter, and DePaul will have good starting position, down by 10. First and 10 from the 44-yard line for Nathan McCahill and company. McCahill came in 21 touchdown passes, only 2 picks. Today, 1 touchdown. But he's now thrown 2 picks. McCahill to throw over the middle, and it's going to be incomplete. Broken up by the Tigers' Anthony Pedro. The intended target was Ballantyne. And actually, I should say 2 TD passes for McCahill today, because the first one was 35 yards to Ballantyne in the first, second one 25 yards to Quigley in the second. Total offense, 230 for Wittenberg, 223 for DePaul. 155 showing second quarter. McCahill asks for the football, gets it, and hands to Whitehead. Starts right, cuts back, spins, and then Whitehead
nice
is met at the 49-yard line and dropped.
Oh, my, what a hit.
Tigers linebacker Tony Colavini.
Colavini with a big hit. Square to square, shoulder to shoulder, and he drove him back. Just planted him right there.
Third and 6 from the 49. DePaul is 6 of 8 on third downs today. They've picked up some big ones to keep drives alive. Let's see if they can do it here. 1:19 left until the break. McCahill. Here comes the pressure. He'll throw deep down the right side, and it's going to be broken up. Once again, they were trying to get the football to Ballantyne, and the Tigers defended it well. Darian Williams on coverage. It'll be 4th and 6, and DePaul will punt.
Great defensive structure there. The wide receiver trying to make a play, but good defense as far as the safety coming back there. They had 2 or 3 guys back there for Wittenberg. Super play to get the ball back with a minute 12 here. Leading by 10, 24-14 here at Edwards-Mauer Field in Springfield, a great day for football. Lots of fans here rooting on their Tigers.
Ben Gomez punts it and shanks it. It's off the right side of his foot and goes out of bounds down around the 35-yard line. Let's see where they're going to
They have to move that
mark
way
it here. Linesman still walking all the way up to the 40. It'll be the 39 is where they'll put the ball down. So decision time here for Jim Collins. You've got 67 seconds. You've got the short field because of the bad punt. And all, take that back, 2 timeouts remaining. They had to use one at the beginning of the last drive. Two timeouts left. Let's see how aggressive Wittenberg wants to be. Up by 10. DePaul gets the ball to start the second half.
And I think he's going to be smart but aggressive. I think the both can play out right here. Be so good to move the football and get another score, but you don't want to throw it away either.
Melton looking. He's going to throw to May. He'll make the catch and step out of bounds quickly at the 43, a gain of 4. 1:02 remaining in the second. So it'll be.
You know, that punt was kind of like one of Jackson's nine irons. You know, just really didn't catch it very well and just kind of drove it to the right side.
Didn't hit a house, though.
No, but I think if he'd been close, he might have.
We go under a minute left in the half as Milton is able to find Dean Tate, who races into DePaul territory at the 49.
Again, smart but aggressive, and nice job.
First and 10 from the 49, 57 seconds left. Second quarter, Scott Leo, the coach Jim Scobie, producer Jackson Lightcap. Rainy afternoon in Springfield, throwing into traffic as Milton, it's incomplete. Wittenberg catches a break. Because Milton threw that ball for Dean Tate, but there were at least four white jerseys in the vicinity there, and it goes off somebody's shoulder pad. It'll be second and 10.
And you can see what we talked about, that this right now, this DePaul team kind of back on their heels a little bit, and that's why it's so important. If Wittenberg can move the football and maybe get another three or a touchdown, what a big thing to go in at halftime.
50 seconds remaining. Milton, a couple receivers out to the left. He's looking in that direction, steps up, avoids the sack, goes into a slide and gets hit, and here comes the flag.
That's right.
Milton went to give himself up on the slide, and as he did so, he was hit by Luke Nolan, the junior defensive end. It's a tough spot for the defensive player to be in, because he was already approaching. The question is, did he leave his feet before Milton went into the slide, and the officials don't believe so.
Yeah, you're right. And Luke Nolan is the one of the keys on this defense for DePaul. That was a play, aggressive play, but smart run by Max Milton.
So we'll get the call here. The officials are talking about it.
After the play is over, personal foul, late hit. Defense, number 8, 15-yard penalty, first down.
And again, it's so tough for the defensive player who is running full speed, getting ready to make a tackle, and then the quarterback gives himself up. But I think in that case, Milton did start the slide before Nolan had lunged for the tackle, and so that's why you get the call, and that's why you get 15 yards tacked onto the end of the play, and Wittenberg has it at the DePaul 32 with 44 seconds left. Remember, Wittenberg still has two timeouts available as they try to add to a 10-point lead here in the final minute of the half. Milton looking right, fires. It's May, makes the catch, can't get out of bounds, so Wittenberg should probably use one of those timeouts here, and they do. May is down to the 26-yard line, a gain of 6. Timeout Wittenberg, one remaining.
Tigers in a great position, though. They are sitting pretty tight again. Second down and about 37 seconds here to try to get it in the end zone. And as you said, they have one more timeout, but you got to be really smart with it, and you've got to make sure you get a first down here. We'll stop the clock, and then you've got to go into a mode where you're really aggressive. You got to pull out maybe, you know, one of those plays that you save for this occasion.
How about this? The sun peaks out momentarily here at Edwards-Mauer Field as we celebrate 100 years of this stadium. First game played here 100 years ago yesterday, and Wittenberg's trying to celebrate the anniversary by knocking off the DePaul Tigers, who are 7-0 on the year, 5-0 in the conference. Wittenberg is 4-0 in NCAC play. Wittenberg's lone season loss coming at home against Alma out of the Michigan Intercollegiate Athletic Association, a 48-28 setback. Second down and 3 from the 25. 36 seconds left. Let's see if Max Milton and the Wittenberg offense can cash in for more points here.
You don't need a sack here. You got to be smart with it. Get rid of it if you have to.
Milton will throw for May, and he just misses him. It's incomplete. If he puts it right between the numbers, May's going to make the catch, but Milton misses his mark just a bit. It'll be third down on coverage for DePaul was Emmanuel Dua, the senior. So now third and three. Wittenberg on third downs today, 4 of 7. Tigers are now over 250 yards of offense for the afternoon. Hand to Anderson, and he's going to be hit, but stays on his feet, spins away, still churning his legs. He'll get a little bit, a hard yard maybe. And it'll be 4th and 2, and Wittenberg will use that last timeout with 20 seconds left.
And Jim Collins has got to decide, do I, you know, go for it here? This would be living on the edge.
Yeah, Brandon Goodwin hit on a 31-yard kick earlier, right. But this one would be more
longer.
Like 41 yards.
Yeah, yeah.
Be about 40, 41 yards, and so there's no indication that Jim Collins wants to kick it. In fact, he took Max Milton, his quarterback, out of the offensive huddle, and right now it's the head coach and the quarterback having a discussion about what to do next on 4th down and 2.
Right. And, again, a situation where, you know, you really like to get that first down, but, you know, if you miss the field goal, you know, DePaul gets it back in pretty good field position. So, you know, the situation kind of sets itself up. But if Wittenberg could get a first down here, that'll stop the clock, and then they could get about maybe 2 or 3 shots.
Yeah, I mean, DePaul has all 3 timeouts, but with only 20 seconds left, I don't think you worry about whether or not you're giving them the ball back here. You're just trying to decide what play can get you 2 or more yards to keep this drive going. Now, remember, Wittenberg is out of timeouts, so if they do pick up the first down, they'll get a moment while the chains get set. They'll have to hurry to the line and get it spiked if they're able to convert. 4th and 2 from the 24. Milton has Anderson as his running back to his right. Milton to throw, and it's going to be caught. He underthrew the running back on the screen.
Catch.
But they call it a catch. Now, the DePaul sideline acted as if it was incomplete. The question is, did it hit the carpet?
Well, there's no camera.
And, yeah, you can't replay it. He's down to the 20-yard line. It's a pickup of 4 yards. It'll be first down Wittenberg unless somebody overrules the call.
Somebody did.
Yep. That's going to be the call.
Field is an incomplete pass. First down, DePaul.
So it is an incomplete pass, and Wittenberg turns it over on downs with 12 seconds remaining. So DePaul will take over here, but I'm guessing they, from inside their own 25, probably won't take too many chances with 12 seconds left. You've got time for a couple plays. They are going to take a knee. So they're going to get this game to the locker room, and that's where we will be after 30 minutes of football as McCahill gets the snap, drops down on his right knee, and with 2 quarters in the books, it'll be Wittenberg 24, DePaul 14, in a battle of NCAC unbeatens here in Springfield, Wittenberg trying to defend its home turf and get a big, big win late in the season during a tough part of the schedule for Jim Collins' team. Once again at the half, Wittenberg 24, DePaul 14 here on the Tiger Sports Network.
will have three national qualifiers: Corinne Turkovich for cross country, Jalissa Williams for high jump, and Sydney Colson for steeplechase. We would also like to recognize Sydney Colson on her amazing accomplishments. Sydney was a national runner-up in the Division III NCAA Outdoor Championships for the 3,000-meter steeplechase. Her run at Nationals was the seventh fastest time in Division III history. Congratulations on a successful three seasons.
Presenting the pride of Kenton Ridge, the Marching Cougar Band. The band is under the direction of Mr. Jim Templeton and Mrs. Alyssa Berger. Thank you. Each year, the seniors select one song from their 4 years of marching band to bring back. This year, they have selected Gone, Daddy, Gone. Thank you. To close tonight's show, the band will feature our own Dixieland band. We hope you enjoy Wade in the Water.
Wittenberg leads DePaul 24-14 as we begin the second half here in Springfield. Scott Leo, the coach, Jim Scobie with you. First half numbers, Wittenberg outgained DePaul 252-226. 14 Wittenberg first downs, 11 for DePaul. On third down, Tigers 4 of 8. Wittenberg Tigers 4 of 8. DePaul 6 of 9. Wittenberg tried and failed on the only fourth down attempt in this game. Neither team has recorded a sack. The turnovers, 2 for DePaul, a pair of interceptions. One of them returned for a touchdown by the Wittenberg defense. Max Milton, the Tiger quarterback, 15 of 23, 201, a TD, no picks. Nathan McCahill for DePaul, 10 of 20, 173, 2-2. And we're ready to get this second half underway. DePaul will get the football. The rain has subsided. The sun peeked out for a moment right at the end of the first half, but it is gone again behind the heavy overcast cloud cover. And for Wittenberg, it'll be Hayden Alcott to kick it away, and back deep to return for DePaul is Simmons Little as well as Alex Hoover, and this kick will bounce and go out of bounds on the far sideline. So the DePaul offense will set up shop here with a deficit of 10 points on the road. DePaul trying to remain unbeaten on the year. They'll start it from their own
35-yard line.
Yes, sir. And so here comes the DePaul offense. Time of possession, Wittenberg 15-46, DePaul 14-14 in the first half. Each team with 4 penalties. It cost DePaul 45 yards, Wittenberg 25 yards. McCahill will have Whitehead behind him. It's a 3-receiver set, 2 of them off to the left. Get the snap, hands it off, and back to the line of scrimmage. Maybe a yard or 2 goes Whitehead. They'll mark him near the 37. So it'll be 2nd down and 8.
And again, Whitehead was the main ball totaler in the first half. He's a guy they went to a lot. And
it's his 11th carry.
They started off with straight up the middle. So he's becoming the main man back there in the backfield. Tigers, again, had both teams going in at halftime, and Wittenberg, the momentum completely changed. It's jumped back and forth in this game. But
McCahill hands to Whitehead running right. He's going to cut it back and get a couple of yards out near the 39, where he is eventually taken to the turf. So it'll be 3rd down and 6, and here comes the first big 3rd down play of the second half. A couple of running plays for DePaul, maybe trying to set up something through the air.
They've had their, what is it?
They're 6 of 9.
6 of 9, which is pretty good.
Yeah, Wittenberg's just 4 of 8. It's been an issue for Wittenberg converting on 3rd downs this year, but Tiger defense, the Red Swarm D, has done a really good job today. DePaul's gained some yards, but the Tiger defense has forced a couple of turnovers, and now they're going to try and get off the field right here on a 3 and out. 13:49 left in the third. A handoff goes to Whitehead. He'll bounce it out to the right side. He's got the 1st down to Wittenberg territory. Lunges forward across the 50, and he's out of bounds at the Wittenberg 48. It's a run of 13 yards.
The Tigers expected that ball to go right up the gut. But Whitehead shows you he's physical, but he can also turn it on. He got to the outside, read it well, and then once he got the corner, he took it all the way up the sideline. 1st down for DePaul.
McCahill from the shotgun, and he's going to throw it out to the left side for Quigley, who caught it and then gets tackled immediately. Stop was made by Wittenberg's Max Yost, who was able to get away from the blocker. Basically, the blocker had him tied up on the left side of his body. He used his right arm to get free, get a hold of Quigley, and bring him to the ground. It was Ballantyne who was trying to block him out there in space.
And that's a good sign of a great defensive player being able to get off the block and make the play. We talk about it with our defensive linemen, but you saw it right there with a corner.
Yep, give goes to Whitehead up the middle, and he's going to have the 1st down inside the 40, down to the Wittenberg 37. 12-yard carry for Caden Whitehead.
Wow, you hate to see that. 2 gashes right away to start the second half, and Whitehead is just starting to get it going. He's a very good running back, and you know, what I like about him is once he sees he's a north and south runner, doesn't like to run it sideways, and if he hits the hole, he can really, really move. You saw it right there on a first and 10, and now they're first and 10 from the 38.
And McCahill's going to throw, far sideline incomplete, missing Jalen Smith. Wittenberg was able to get to McCahill and knock him to the ground after he let that pass fly. It'll be second and 10.
When the Tigers have been able to pressure McCahill, he's a different passer. He really, really hurries his passes, and that's something that Wittenberg's got to continue to do. But right now they got to stop the running back.
Second down and 10 from the 37, 12-14 to play in the third. Here's Whitehead. Cuts it back, has room inside the 30, down to the 25. So it's the running attack that's doing the damage for DePaul. Caden Whitehead, it's his show here on this drive. He's down to the 23-yard line, 14 yards, first down DePaul as we go under 12 minutes remaining in the quarter.
Yeah, he's playing really well, Whitehead, right now. And the holes are there, but he's had three runs for close to 40 yards.
So McCahill will have Whitehead behind him. It's a three-receiver set, two to the left. And they'll hand it again. Whitehead up the middle, inside the 20, down to the 16. 8 yards for Caden Whitehead. He is just churning those legs. He's had some big holes to run through on this drive.
Now, what helps DePaul in this situation? They've run it two, three times, and that's going to open things up on the outside as far as throwing the football. And this is a situation with McCahill, second down and short. He may try to go to the end zone on this.
Second down, two to go from the Wittenberg 16-yard line. McCahill gets the football, hands it off. Whitehead right up the middle, and he's going to be close to a first down. Needed to get to the 14, and that's about where they're going to mark him down. It is a first down to DePaul, gain of two.
And, you know, if you're DePaul, you go with the girl you came to the dance with, and that's what Whitehead's done right now.
Oh, my mistake. The official over on the far side and the referee, I thought, were pointing first down, but they say it's third down and less than a yard. So the nose of the football is just shy of the 14. We're talking third and inches here. And Whitehead is in the backfield. Let's see if he gets it again. He does, and he's going to spin away from a tackler, but he won't get back to the line of scrimmage. He loses half a yard. Back to the 15. It'll be fourth and one for DePaul. Big-time play there for the Tigers, as Tony Colavini once again gets his name called. The linebacker getting help up front as well from a couple of teammates. Fourth and a little more than a yard here for DePaul with just under 10 minutes to go in the third. What a big play coming up. It's the first fourth down attempt of the day for DePaul.
Yeah, Colavini, a senior out of Etna, Ohio, played for Watkins Memorial. This is a big play in this game.
They'll hand it off.
Whitehead
got back to the line of scrimmage, but doesn't get to the 14.
Nope.
The Wittenberg defense holds again. This time they get a couple of huge stops with less than a yard to go, and Wittenberg's defense turns DePaul away on the first possession of the second half.
They just got super physical in there in the trenches, and made up their mind they were not going to let Whitehead get an extra yard. That's two in a row that they stepped up and made big plays. That's got to boost your offense now.
And, well, Caden Whitehead was just chewing the Wittenberg defense up on that drive, and then all of a sudden the Tigers again bow their backs and turn DePaul away.
Yeah, it was kind of shocking the way he was running the football, and wasn't really even touched till he got to the deep part of the Tiger defense.
They'll hand it off for Garrett Gross. Bounces it out to the right. Here comes a flag. Gross goes down at the 23.
That's going to go against the Tigers.
Jim Collins over here on the near sideline asking for an explanation. We're going to get a hold, I believe.
Holding offense, number 13, 10-yard penalty, first down.
It's a hold on the receiver, Tyler May.
Yeah, he just got his hand in there and grabbed in a situation where you don't see that a lot from your wide receiver, but that time they got him. And this is not good. Again, Wittenberg's done this a couple times. It's first and 10 deep in their territory, and they have a penalty. So now it's first and 20, and you got to kind of chew things up and definitely be careful here because you cannot have a mistake in this area.
Yeah, first and 20 from their own 7-yard line. Max Milton hands to Gross, gets undercut just across the line of scrimmage, maybe gets a yard out to the 8. Second down and 19 coming up for Wittenberg. Luke Marsh on the stop for DePaul again. This is a DePaul team that has rolled through the first 7 games of their season. They beat Ohio Wesleyan by 3 touchdowns at home, and then they beat DePaul 17-6 2 weeks ago, but those were both home games. This is by far the toughest road game that DePaul has had to face during their unbeaten NCAC run so far this year. Milton's pass is incomplete. He threw it behind May. Tyler couldn't come back to it. It'll be 3rd and 17.
And again, if you're Wittenberg, you'd like to get enough yards to maybe get it out to, say, about the 20, if you can, and so you can punt this thing away. Or make a big play and get the first down, but that's a long ways. 3rd and 18.
Got to make sure you take care of the football here first and foremost. No turnovers, but DePaul will drop 8 into coverage. Milton's going to throw it deep, and it's going to be intercepted. He was trying to force that to Dean Tate out across the 30-yard line, but DePaul had it covered up nicely. There's a flag down. There's a flag down. And if it's against Wittenberg, DePaul will decline it. That ball was kind of thrown up for grabs by Milton. Ineligible man.
Offense, number 51. That penalty is declined. First down.
So there's the first Wittenberg turnover of the game. That's what we were talking about there. Even though you're backed up and it's third and long, you'd much rather give Hayden Alcott a chance to punt it away, even if he's standing in his own
Absolutely.
End zone. He's got a big leg. Give yourself some breathing room. But Milton trying to force it there. He's got Dean Tate, who is as explosive as any receiver in the conference, and he's trying to just get it into his hands. Instead, it's overthrown and picked off.
And it's a situation where DePaul wanted to flip the field. They did, and then they get the big turnover. So now, you know, they've got a chance to get in deep into Wittenberg territory, and here we go.
Yeah, hand it to Whitehead from the 31. He'll get down to the 26, a gain of 5. Nolan Tooley is the guy that had the interception for DePaul.
And this offensive line of DePaul has woken up because some of these holes you could drive a truck through, and Moorhead is just absolutely chewing up yardage. Left and right.
Second down and 5 from the 26. Handed to Whitehead again. Cuts it back, and he'll get to the 20. He's got the first down.
What's amazing about it, Scott, is there's no one around him. I mean, he's literally untouched.
He's to the 18 on that carry, Coach. That's 8 yards.
Yeah, he's going 8, 10, 15, 20 yards, and hardly is touched coming from the backfield off tackle. It's just really been kind of amazing. Does not bode well for Wittenberg's defense.
Here's a whistle. The officials will stop play momentarily. Play clock was down to 11. Game clock at 7:28. They're going to reset the play clock. From the gun. Handoff, and this will be Simmons Little. Gives Whitehead a breather. Down to the 13, a pickup of 5. At DePaul offensive line, like you said, maybe accepting the halftime challenge as the guys from Greencastle probably heard a little bit about it at halftime in the DePaul locker room.
And right now the Tiger defensive front 5 look a little tired.
Simmons Little gets the handoff and he is met. And this will be a no-gain run at the 13-yard line for Wittenberg. Anthony Pedro, the safety, was up in the hole there to stop it. Also there was Tyree Smith, the linebacker. And here comes third down. Third and five to go from the 13 for DePaul. 6:23 to play, third quarter. Wittenberg leading by 10.
Tiger up time, and right now is when you really want to step up if you're a Tiger.
From the shotgun, McCahill hands it to Whitehead, and he is going to be tripped up shy of the first down marker.
Short.
Coming off the edge, Tyree Smith again. Whitehead was able to reach the football out to the 10.
He's so still two away.
Yeah, he's at least a yard short. Needed to get inside the 9, so about a yard and a half to go. We'll call it 4th and 1 here for DePaul. Ball just outside the 10. 5:44 left in the third quarter. DePaul got stopped on a 4th down and a yard to go on their last possession. They got the ball back with the short field because of an INT. Here they are again, 4th and 1 to go. From the gun, McCahill. Whitehead behind him. And now we've got a whistle and a timeout, DePaul. Coach Scobie, I know this is something that drives you crazy, but we've seen it so many times. It's become commonplace. Teams working from the shotgun even with a yard to go.
Yeah, that doesn't make sense. In fact, it's funny you said that, Scott, because I had to relook at it and thought, what in the heck are you doing? Because the way they've been running the football, you don't want to have that much distance for Whitehead to have to go, and you want him to be able to not wait on the football, but, you know, come to it. On the flip side also, you would like to see your quarterback up close. If you want to call a short yardage quarterback sneak, you can. It's a little too far for a sneak, but I agree with you, Scott. You don't want to put yourself way back. That's one thing. Basically, what you're saying in a situation like that is, you know, it's a passing down. Now, what happened was
they're bringing out the field goal team here after the timeout.
Yeah, they decide to get at least 3.
So this would be a 28-yard try from Joseph Sullivan, the senior kicker, ball on the right hash mark, to try and make it a 7-point ball game. Snap back, hold down, kick is away, and from 27 yards, he missed it.
Wow.
He missed the field goal.
Wow.
And so DePaul lines up to go for it on 4th and about a yard and a half. They change their mind. They use a timeout. They bring the kicking team out, and that backfires.
Well, and that's the second time that Wittenberg's been able to stop them inside the red zone. And both times, once was on a 4th down handoff where Wittenberg withstood actually a 3rd and a 4th down run. And this time, they decide DePaul, I think, was a little shook from that first drive, and they decide to get 3 points. But when they do, you know, he just has a really bad kick. There's no wind blowing. There's nothing that could have forced that to go down. It was just came off his foot bad.
So, 1st and 10 Tigers, Wittenberg, from their own 20 after the missed field goal. They'll hand it off, and Bryce Anderson is going to be stopped. A loss of 2. Back at the 18, it'll bring up 2nd and 12.
I'll tell you what, DePaul, like you said, Scott, somebody got in their ears because they have absolutely played aggressive here in this start of the third quarter. That time, this defense, as soon as the ball was snapped, they were in the backfield. And that's kind of the way the offense has been with the running game. So Wittenberg's got to get some rhythm here.
Two receivers left. Melton, pump fake, fires out into the flats. It'll be caught. There's a flag down back near the line of scrimmage. It was Dean Tate who caught it but was immediately wrapped up. DePaul is saying we're going to get a hold against Wittenberg. 4:40 left in the third quarter.
Holding offense.
Yeah, that's
51, 10-yard penalty. Correction, half the distance to the goal, 2nd down.
And again, Scott, a catastrophic penalty.
It's the left guard, Andrew McFeeters.
It's just been it's been ugly because it just puts yourself back in the hole again, and it forces you to have to try to dig yourself out. And in this situation, this part of the field, it's really, really hard.
I think DePaul is declining the penalty. They marched it off half the distance, so it would have put the ball back around the 9-yard line. But, well, now they've got it at the 21. So it should be
third down.
They put the ball at the 21.
That's an interesting play call right there. I think
so. It should be third and – so it'll be third and 9 from the 21.
Right.
Four receivers set here for Wittenberg. Milton throws on the screen pass. Anderson has the first down, still on his feet across the 35 to the 40, and then he's ripped down. Wittenberg's sideline wanted a face mask call. They won't get it. First down, Wittenberg on a pickup of 20 yards on the screen pass.
Boy, that's going to be a play that's going to be dissected right there as far as not taking the penalty and pushing them back to inside the 5-yard line. They decide to decline it, and then a great screen pass there to Anderson, and he picks up the first down, gets them out of trouble.
Gives them a little room to work with here now at their own 41-yard line. Hand off Anderson again. Hesitates, finds space, runs right up the middle, and keeps turning those legs all the way out to the 48. A gain of 7 yards for Bryce Anderson, the grad student. Anderson, with a veteran presence in that Tiger offense for sure. Out of Indianapolis, Lawrence Central High School, 5'7". 200-pound running back. Great vision with the football. This time they'll spin it out to Tate. Caught it at the line of scrimmage, goes up the right sideline, and tiptoes down the sideline to the 42. It's a gain of 10 yards. First down, Wittenberg.
Tigers trying to find a rhythm right now, and again, they're doing it with balance. They're running it and throwing it, and just got to stay away from these penalties.
Still a ways to go here, but if Wittenberg goes down and gets a touchdown, that makes it awfully tough on DePaul. They'd be down 3 scores with the PAT. Be a 17-point game as Anderson goes right up the gut down to the 39, a pickup of 3 more. Could make it a 17-point game either at the end of the third quarter or maybe even early in the fourth quarter, and then all of a sudden, with still a lot of football left, the clock does start to become a factor early on.
It really does become an issue. And, again, this is so important, this drive. Tigers could take a lot of pressure off themselves.
Three receivers set, two to the right. Milton looks across at that DePaul defensive front. Calls for the football, has it. Anderson protecting. Milton steps up. He's going to throw deep for Tyler May. He makes the catch and got a foot down.
Oh, my.
He got his left foot down at the 13-yard line. Another tremendous grab on a deep ball from Tyler May. He's had 2 big catches today, one of them an 81-yard touchdown strike. This one, the Tigers are able to pick up 31 yards and set up first and goal.
Yeah, if we ended the game right now, they'd give the game ball to Tyler May. He's made 3 really big plays. Now, it's important. You have to finish it off. This has been an area where Wittenberg sometimes has difficulty. But right now, the momentum is on their side. They've got to find a way to maybe get a first on this first down, a big play.
Give goes to Anderson. He's going to be hit at the line of scrimmage at the 9, taken down there. Maybe lost a half yard. May has 6 catches, Coach, 165 yards.
That's crazy. It's crazy.
So he's averaging about 27, 28 yards per reception. Long of 81. Big day today for number 13.
You get a feeling that maybe Max Milton might somehow, if he could, you know, make a play running the football or whatever to get this first down, would be great.
Looking to throw. Milton up the middle of the field. It's going to be off the hands of his target, Troy Teepee, right up the middle of the field. Teepee trying to make an over-the-shoulder catch about 8 yards deep in the end zone. Cannot haul it in. And it's third and goal.
He'd like to have that back. That was right there. Unfortunately, you know, if you're a wide receiver, you got to catch it with your hands. And it was almost like he tried to umbrella it and try to put his hands out there and catch it with 2 arms. And that's a difficult catch.
104 left in the third. Huge play here. Third and goal from the 9. Melton looking. Throws over the middle. It's broken up. Looking for Troy Teepee. And excellent coverage that time by Tommy Ryan, the senior safety, who gets his right hand up and knocks it away. And so Wittenberg will be forced to bring on the kicking unit and try to walk away with 3.
One thing Max did wrong there, he basically kept his eye on the one receiver. He had one idea the whole time, and that allowed DePaul to drop 2 linebackers in that vicinity. So it was very hard to get anything in there. This is a big kick right here.
26 yards, Brandon Goodwin. It is up, and it is good.
That's big.
So Goodwin has been perfect today. He has converted on 2 field goals and 3 extra points. And Wittenberg leads 27-14 with 56 seconds to go, third quarter. So the Tigers, Wittenberg, unable to push it to a 3-score game, but they do tack on 3 more. And so DePaul has to be a little bit frustrated with the fact that a couple times now they have been able to get in Wittenberg territory but not come away with any points. Missed field goal this last time. They've had a pair of interceptions thrown, a turnover on downs. And so Hayden Alcott will kick it away for Wittenberg. From his own 7-yard line on the return. Out across the 20 and then de-cleated there is the return man, Simmons Little. He got hammered at the 23-yard line, knocked off his feet. So DePaul has had some good kickoff returns today, which has set their offense up nicely, but this one will be some of their worst starting position that they've seen this afternoon.
And as we get close to the fourth quarter, 51 seconds, the best football has to happen here in this fourth quarter. This is what you work for. You're in the driver's seat, but you've got to play physical football. You can't rest on your laurels at all.
I'll spin it out to the left side where it is caught by Jalen Smith, but the Tigers able to get to him pretty quickly and bring him down at the 24, a gain of only 1 yard. Second down and 9 for DePaul.
They always say on defense you have to move forward, and you saw it right there on that throw in the flat. Both the corners and the safety came up. They're moving forward and made the play.
Now hand it off to Whitehead going up the middle, and he'll get to the 29. That'll be 5 yards on the final play of the third quarter. So 3 quarters in the books, and Wittenberg leads DePaul 27-14 in a battle of NCAC unbeatens. Sole possession of first place on the line. And once again, after
Tiger
3,
up, baby.
Wittenberg 27, DePaul 14 on the Tiger Sports Network. 15 minutes left to decide this one in the NCAC here at Edwards-Mauer Field, celebrating 100 years of this stadium. Third down and 5 to DePaul from their own 29. And McCahill will fire. A flag comes in. The catch is made at the 35. And that's Quigley out to the 38. Let's see what the penalty is all about. They're going to back him up, I believe. And there's an injured DePaul Tiger over on the far side of the field. Well, the DePaul Tigers are saying it's against Wittenberg. The result of the play was enough for a first down. Quigley's out to the
defense, number 93. Illegal hands to the face. 15-yard penalty added to the end of the run. First down.
Hands to the face. That's 15 yards.
Yeah, defensive injury.
That's, again, one of those plays you really have to try to get rid of. If there's one negative that I've seen with Wittenberg, it's been a number of the penalty calls against him. And just, you know, some of that is just mental toughness. And Wittenberg, certainly, that happens in the middle of the field. You don't want that to happen anymore. Those penalties are like turnovers.
So 14:52 left in the game. DePaul will have it at the Wittenberg 47-yard line. Total yards today, Wittenberg 326, DePaul 312. Tigers have 265 passing, Wittenberg to 182 for DePaul. And on the ground, Wittenberg has rushed it for 61, but DePaul has rushed the ball now for 130 yards. They've been able to get it done on the ground, especially in the second half. They had two drives where they ran the ball extremely well, but then didn't come up with any points.
Yeah, that was explosion by Whitehead, where he had those three or four or five incredible runs.
Simmons Little is the running back here. They'll throw it out to him on the screen play. He's going to get down to the 45, knocked off his feet near the 42. 5-yard gain to Cooper Simmons Little.
Again, keep these DePaul Tigers in front of you. You can't let anybody get behind you, and you just want to be physical, move your feet. Stay low, get your hands up, fight off these offensive blockers and get to the quarterback.
It's Carson Johnson wearing number 2 for DePaul, getting time in the backfield. They'll throw it out to the right side here where the catch is made at the 42, and then down to the 36 goes Quigley. He picks up enough for the first down. He gained 6 when they needed 5. So under 14 to play in the game. Wittenberg leading by 13, so DePaul needs a couple touchdowns, and they need to do it here in the final 13:46 and counting.
Tigers need to be aware of, again, that time they tried to blitz from the left corner, and they threw right into that area and got the first down. They cannot let a team get behind them.
McCahill hands to Quigley running right side, and the big fellow is going to be tackled near the 34. Gabe Quigley, 6'3", 220 pounds. Gain of 2 on the tight end sweep, if you will. Second down and 8, 13:17 remaining.
Quigley is one of those guys for DePaul that's been around a long time, and he's kind of like the guy that settles them. He's a little bit of an anchor on this team.
Under 13 minutes left to play. McCahill looking to throw, has a man all alone at the 5. Caught it, touchdown, Robbie Ballantyne. He got behind the Wittenberg defense and was all alone for a 34-yard strike. And with 12:56 remaining, it's Wittenberg 27, DePaul 20.
Yeah, we just said that again. You cannot let them get behind you. And that time the defensive front made a little bit of an impression by coming after him, but he hung in, stepped forward, and threw that thing. What was unusual, Scott, is how wide open the DePaul receiver was.
Yeah, nobody ran with him in the secondary, and the PAT is good to make it 27-21 with 12:56 remaining. DePaul needed that score in a big way. In fact, DePaul holding Wittenberg to a field goal on that last possession and now getting a touchdown here really makes it so that They don't have to worry too much about the clock this early in the fourth quarter. They just need stops on defense, and they're going to try to do that right here as they send their defense back out after this kickoff. See how Wittenberg approaches it. Tigers have done a nice job of balancing the run and the pass. Max Milton is 19 of 31 for 265 yards. They haven't had big rushing plays. Bryce Anderson had one 16-yard carry, but they've been held to, as we said, about 60 yards rushing for the entire game. But they've done enough in the ground game that it's opened up some bigger passing plays. We'll see if they can get that ground game maybe going even more here in the late stages to keep drives alive and keep the clock running.
Yeah, you need one of those drives that runs a lot of clock and can move the ball down and score. That would be taking time off the clock would be huge.
On the return, here comes Dean Tate. Out across the 20, stiff arms a man at the 25, and out of bounds he goes, and a flag comes in at the end of this play as Tate gets shoved out of bounds near the 28-yard line. The first contact took Tate out of bounds, and then the second hit might have been
now
a late hit.
DePaul's pointing in as if it's against Wittenberg. So clearly looked like
not sure what the flag would be on Wittenberg because it came
hit.
Clearly at the very end of the play.
Yeah,
a late hit from a blocker.
It would be interesting to see if they call this off.
During the return, personal foul, face mask, number 10 on the receiving team. The penalty's enforced half the distance to the goal, first down.
So the face mask had to have come right at the tail end of the play.
Right.
The flag came in as Tate was already out of bounds.
Yep.
So I'm guessing the blocker who was there blocking for Tate must have grabbed some face mask as they were out of bounds or going out of bounds.
And again, we've seen this picture a lot where Wittenberg in this quarter and late in the third, there have been four situations with penalties that have kicked it back about 10 yards. So at least this is first and 10. So Tigers need to get some rhythm, get it going.
First down carry right up the middle. Garrett Gross back to the line of scrimmage, which was the 14, maybe gains a half yard. It'll be second down, 9 to go, 12:34 left in the football game. Wittenberg 27, DePaul 21. As this Wittenberg offense tries to put together a drive and go down and get points, make this a two-score difference again. Milton out into the flats for Tate. Makes the catch. He's able to get around one would-be tackler, spins away from a second one partially, and gets very close to a first down. They're going to mark him out near the 24-yard line. That is enough for the first down, I believe. Let's see.
Well, I'll tell you, Tate is...
Nope, never mind. So the linesman, that's the second time he's done that. He's pointed.
Right.
Okay, he did say first down. Earlier they did that, and I thought it was a first down on a DePaul offensive drive, and it wasn't. So this time it is first down, Tigers. Dean Tate picks up nine.
What a good play by Dean Tate to keep the ball, keep his feet moving, and pick up that extra first down.
Looking to throw. Milton to Tate again. He'll catch it, and he'll get to the 30-yard line, a pickup of six. Wittenberg now getting the ball into the hands of their best athlete here, trying to find a way to get number 10 more and more involved.
Boy, and he's so smooth, a little guy, but I'll tell you what, he's slippery. And this is where you can open things up. Someone can actually, you know, in this situation, they're going to put two guys over there and move the safety over, so somebody else is going to be open.
Handoff, Garrett Gross sheds a tackler, runs over another one. He's got the first down out to the 37-yard line. 8 yards for Garrett Gross right up the middle. And the Wittenberg offense is moving here with 10:49 left in the game.
Now that's Tiger football right there, and you saw it. He just ran over a guy. Blocking was there. Tigers on the move. They've got a nice rhythm going. Keep it up.
It'll be a three-receiver look here, two receivers to the right, one to the left, and Gross in the backfield to the left of Milton. Tate goes in motion left side. 10:25 left to play. Milton, here comes pressure, and he's going to be sacked. Max Milton will go down back at the 33-yard line. First time DePaul has been able to get to him today. It is Ethan Lowry, the senior nose tackle, who is able to record the sack. A loss of 4 yards. And it'll bring up second and 14 from Wittenberg's own 34.
Yeah, last week DePaul had 4 sacks. This was their first one today, and you've got to eliminate that. Give Milton some time.
They're protecting him here. Milton to throw. Looking for Tyler May again. He's got it at the 40.
He's going
to
go.
Tyler May off to the races. 46 yards and a Wittenberg touchdown. The throw was to the inside of the receiver in the corner, and Tyler May saw it. He adjusted. He came back to the football, hauls it in, and then just runs past all the DePaul defenders for the score. 9:36 to play in the game, and Wittenberg pushes the lead back to 2 touchdowns. It's 33-21.
And Max Milton went with the hot hand. He went again and threw it into Tyler May, who's made some great catches today. What a fabulous call. And we'll see what happens on this particular play. It looks like Wittenberg's going to go for 2, Scott.
Going to go for 2 to try and make it a full 14-point lead. Force DePaul to need 2 touchdowns plus PATs. Timeout called here as Wittenberg wants to talk it over before the 2-point conversion attempt with 9:36 to play. That's all Tyler May
Tyler
there.
May is
Milton
just
didn't make a bad throw. He made a throw to where the defensive back couldn't
to
get
back
to it.
Yeah.
But May, tremendous job adjusting to get to the football. And so,
well, they
46-yard strike. Wittenberg now in business here to, if they get the 2-point conversion, go up by 14 in the fourth quarter.
Well, they always say, Scott, that in great and big games, players make plays. And Tyler May has certainly made this a career day, one of those special days that he'll never forget. And, again, we still got 9:36 to go, but he has made some huge, huge catches. And how about Max Milton? He continues to grind. A lot of guys might have, you know, thought, well, I can't seem to get it going. He's fought through it, and now the rhythm is on the Tigers' side.
So they'll line up for the 2-point conversion with Garrett Gross in the backfield.
A lot of times they run the fade on this.
Sidecar right here is Gross. 2 receivers to the right. Milton gets the snap. He's going to throw it up the middle of the field. Troy Teepee caught it back of the end zone, the 2-point conversion. Troy Teepee dropped that exact pass for a touchdown at the other end of the field earlier. He doesn't drop it on the 2-point conversion, and it's 35-21 Wittenberg.
Smart play again by Coach Collins. This time I think DePaul thought he was going to throw the corner route, and they had 2 or 3 guys over there, and Teepee snuck across the middle, no linebacker around, kind of thrown behind him. He had to make a really great catch there, and they get the 2 points, and how does that help you with a 2-touchdown lead? But we still have got to stop this offense. Wittenberg, though, has to feel really good. And now it's going to come down to possessions. You know, not letting DePaul have any possessions. And getting off the field quick and then getting the ball and running clock.
So it was a 6-play, 86-yard scoring drive. It took 3 minutes and 12 seconds. Max Milton to Tyler May from 66 yards out. And the 2-point conversion, Milton finds Troy Teepee. And so now the pressure really on the DePaul Tigers, down 2 touchdowns midway through this fourth quarter. Fair catch called for and taken on the kickoff. And here comes the DePaul offense. So, from their own 25-yard line, DePaul will go to work. Wittenberg trying to beat DePaul for the second year in a row and for the 6th time in the last 7 tries. Today, the junior QB, Max Milton, has thrown for 345 yards. He's 22 of 34. And
Got a sack.
He got a sack because McCahill kept the football. Looked like a zone replay, and he pulled it back, but wrong decision. The Tiger defense was ready for him. It's going to be a loss of a couple.
Tigers were in his front yard right now and made the play. Whitehead looked like he had the ball, and he was going down the field.
Yeah. It'll be second and 12. McCahill again to throw. Steps up. Now he's directing traffic, wants Whitehead to take off. He's going to run with it. McCahill out across the 30 to the 31. Max Melton, two touchdowns, one interception. Both touchdown passes have gone to Tyler May. Seven catches, 231 yards for May.
Yeah, that's got to be a career day, and that's phenomenal. You know, seven catches, 231, and how many touchdowns, two?
Two, both of them to May, yep. Two, and then Nathan McCahill, three touchdowns but two picks. He had only thrown three interceptions all year coming into this one.
That's right.
Third down, three to go from DePaul's own 32-yard line. McCahill, he will keep it, throw it down the left side. It's going to be caught. That is Jalen Smith with the reception in Wittenberg territory. He is down to the 36. That is going to be 32 yards.
You know, Tigers right now, you know, they're still playing man-to-man, and that time they got a nice move off the corner.
Free play here. Wittenberg jumped off sides, and the pass is complete. Complete to Hunt Heldebrand, the sophomore, who goes out of bounds at the 27. Wittenberg jumped off side, so it was a free play. They'll decline the 5-yard penalty to take the gain of 8.
You know, Scott, this is where the Tigers
offside. Defense, number 92, the penalty is declined. Second down.
They have to stifle this offense. They have to find it. This is your game right here. You cannot let them get in the end zone. You've got to fight through everything. DePaul knows they have to have a touchdown. And so Wittenberg is going to have to stop them. They have to find a way to end this this drive.
Under 8 minutes left in the game. Give to Whitehead up the middle to the 25. Down to the 24. Gain of 3 yards. That's enough for a first down. So DePaul moves the sticks to the 24-yard line. 35-21 Wittenberg. Wittenberg's defense has provided a touchdown today on a interception return from Jordan Stipe of 65 yards back in the second quarter. They've kicked a couple of field goals and a two-point conversion after this last touchdown, giving them a lead of 14. Whitehead on the carry gets down to the 22, a gain of 2. 7:22 left to play.
That's a good play. Hold him to 2. You got to be aware of DePaul has been successful with misdirection plays. Look for the pick play to try to get someone coming across the field. Just all that stuff has to stay in front of the Tigers. Nothing behind them.
Second down and 8 from the 22. They'll throw it. This is Jalen Smith. He spins away from the defender.
Wow.
He spins to the outside as Jalen Smith, which picks up big-time yards after the catch, down to the 3-yard line. It's a 19-yard completion.
Yeah, he caught it, did a pirouette towards the sideline, and again, finally got up and ran it, almost got the touchdown. So, I mean, this DePaul team can put points up quick.
First and goal, DePaul, from the 3. And they'll hand it off around the end. This is Quigley, and he got hit near the pylon, but the football is in. Gabe Quigley able to reach the ball across the pylon for a 3-yard rushing touchdown. And with 6:34 remaining, it's Wittenberg 35, DePaul 27, as the DePaul Tigers quickly answer.
And a lot of times, 6:34, what a drive by DePaul. That was so critical. And to do it in such a small amount of time, that's what gets you. So Wittenberg now a little bit on their heels, even though they're ahead.
So here comes the PAT, and this is a rather large extra point. Kick is up, and it is good to make it a 7-point game. That was Mac Whistle is the long snapper, the PAT from Joseph Sullivan. Actually, yeah, Daniel Tippett, the holder. So Sullivan converts, and it'll be 35-28. Wittenberg leading by 7 with 6:34 to go, and so this becomes a huge possession now. If Wittenberg can hold on to the football and or go down and put up points, it will make it awfully tough on DePaul.
Yeah, and Wittenberg right now, the last four or so possessions, even with some of those scores, they have had trouble with penalties. They've shot themselves in the foot, and this is where it's critical. You have to play sound football offensively. You can't have any mental mistakes. And DePaul, again, is going to try to throw the kitchen sink because they need one more chance at least to try to tie this game up. So a lot of time with 6:34 to go here. Edwards Mauer Field, 35-28 Wittenberg.
Kick is away, and it is on the return. Elijah Salat out to the 19, maybe to the 20. It's not a whole lot of a return there for Wittenberg's offense to go to work. They've got the long field ahead. 6:27 remaining in the game.
The wind is blowing a little bit out of the south, and so that will help Wittenberg as far as if they need a kick. But it's starting to cool off. It's getting colder. And this is football in Springfield. Tigers, this is what, if they had to dial it up, this is where they'd want to be right now.
So Melton from the gun, he'll have Anderson to his left in a three-receiver look. Each team has two timeouts remaining. Melton hands it off for Anderson up the middle, and he'll fall forward to the 22. A pickup of 2 on first down. Tigers might be content to use a little more of that play clock between snaps here.
Absolutely.
Although it's far too early to be able to just sit on it. Tigers need to move the sticks and keep a drive alive. Ideally, go down and score points as well. 35-28 Wittenberg. 5:53 remaining in the game. Second down and about 8 to go for the Tiger offense. And he'll fake the handoff to Anderson, and Milton will keep it. Calling his own number out to the 25 goes the junior QB. Gain of a few. So 3rd and 5, and a huge play for this DePaul defense as they try to get off the field and give their offense another chance.
This is where you really need somebody like your tight end or someone to make a play, but right now they've got 4 wides. Just enough to get 5.
3rd and 5 from the 25. Milton, high snap, has it on the screen, gets it to Tate. Tate needed the 30-yard line. He won't get there. Taken down at the 27. And so Wittenberg will have to punt it back to DePaul here late in the game in a 7-point contest. With 4:44 to go, clock running. And so here comes the punt team. Hayden Alcott has punted twice today, averaging 44 yards per kick, and he's pinned DePaul inside the 20-yard line once today.
DePaul's coming again.
Right here, you just want to try and get it free. He does. They were coming after that kick. That kick's going to go out of bounds on the near sideline. Not his best kick of the day. It'll go out at the 40. So that's only a 33-yard kick from Alcott. Pretty good starting position for DePaul. They've got 2 timeouts. They've got 4 minutes and 17 seconds. They trail by a touchdown.
And DePaul has to go 60 yards, and Wittenberg's got to stop him. It's that critical. It comes down to this, and look at that time. Always keep your eyes on that time. You want to keep the ball in front of you. Do not give up any big plays. Don't go to a prevent. I think that's the worst thing you can do. Just play solid defense.
McCahill hands to Whitehead, and he's
nice
met.
Nice hit.
Short gain to the 41, a gain of
a
yard.
It's a good start. It's a good start. Let that clock run.
Nathan McCahill today is 18 of 29. 278 yards, 3 touchdowns, 2 picks. On a day where Wabash blew out Kenyon, Hiram beat Oberlin, And the only other game going on is Denison and Worcester as they play in Granville. Worcester leads 21-14 in the third quarter. McCahill throws to midfield. It'll be caught and then taken out of bounds near the first down marker is the receiver. That's Ballantyne, who had the TD reception on the last drive. It is a first down for DePaul. Right at the midfield stripe, 3:34 to play. A lot of time here for DePaul.
Got to go 50 yards. Tigers need a stop.
Plenty of time for this possession for the DePaul Tigers. McCahill hands to White, and he's going to be hit in the backfield. He is taken down for a loss. The guy that got him was Troy Brenninger, the freshman linebacker, gets there, and it's going to be a loss of two back to the 48.
And Brenninger making a name for himself today. The freshman has had some big plays. That one right there might be the best, though. The Tigers have got to be ready to look for anything that the DePaul Tigers throw in front of them. Don't let them go behind them.
Second down and 12 from their own 48. McCahill dumps it off.
Room.
Whitehead into Wittenberg territory, near sideline, and he's shoved out of bounds.
Gee whiz.
But he gets all the way down to the 30.
Yep.
That's a gain of 22. They're going to put him at the 29. Gain
of
23
of time,
yards.
Man. Still 2:38 and the time is moving.
Each team has two timeouts left. DePaul has to have a touchdown here. A field goal does them no good. We're down to 2:23 remaining. McCahill with a four receiver set, three of them to the left. Gets the snap, fires. He throws high, but it's caught down around the 12. And to the pylon goes the receiver, but he stepped out of bounds. Robbie Ballantyne stepped out at the 2. That's a 27-yard completion. Ballantyne got free again, makes a nice catch on a ball that was up above his helmet, was thrown high. And so now DePaul is 2 yards away from a touchdown that with the PAT would tie the game.
And Ballantyne has made two great catches that time. Deep throw to the right side. He went up and just caught it one-on-one.
Wittenberg defense a couple times has had big stops on short yardage situations. They could use one here. Fake the handoff to Whited. And McCahill keeps it, and he's in for the score. So McCahill from 2 yards out rushes it in, and DePaul is a PAT away from tying it. The question is, are they going to kick it or do they go for the win? Do they go for two here? Kind of some milling around. The DePaul offense was standing out there as if they wanted to stay on the field, and they will. DePaul is going to go for two with 1:41 left in the game to try and take the lead.
And this is one of those situations where I know sometimes they say when you're away, you know, you go for it. And this is one of those situations where they might do it.
Timeout called with 1:41 left in the game.
This is where an individual defensive lineman, somebody could make a play. You've got to get to the quarterback. They're probably going to try to either surprise Wittenberg with a play, save a play that they've been holding back for this, or a lot of times teams will just power football, just hand it to their tackle or to their fullback. Moorhead would be a guy that you might want to hand it to. You saw what the quarterback did right there. That was a pretty good play. So we'll see.
DePaul is still, they've got basically the offense and the kicking unit all standing together in that huddle on the far sideline, trying to decide what they're going to do here. And
Tigers need to hold.
They're sending too many of them. Now they got it figured out. It's going to be the kicking team.
Okay.
So the offense started to run out there like they were going to go for it. Maybe some confusion from DePaul, but now they've got the kicking team out there, and here's the PAT to try and tie this game. Joseph Sullivan, perfect on PATs today, and DePaul started early. False start against DePaul. That's going to back him up 5 yards. False start.
Yeah, in this situation, not a big deal, though. In fact, probably a better look at it from this distance rather than right on, you know, right on the goal line. So Tigers.
Sullivan missed on a field goal earlier, but has kicked two extra points. Matthew Berry, a couple PATs. So this amounts to essentially a 26-yard attempt on the PAT to try and tie the game. With 1:41 left, snap back, hold down, the kick is up, and he got it. And so we are back to scratch, 35-35, 1:41 to go, and Wittenberg set to get the football with two timeouts at their disposal. DePaul has one timeout left.
Well, and again, you know, this is a game that, of course, you know, we expected it to come down to right to the end, and that's the way it looks, Scott. The team maybe with the ball last will be the winning team.
Wittenberg has played one overtime game this year. It was a win at Denison. 27-24, Tigers won in overtime in Granville. DePaul has not played an overtime game. Closest margin for DePaul was the 11-point win over Denison 2 weeks ago. These are the last two remaining unbeaten teams in the North Coast Athletic Conference. Winner has sole possession of first place. Loser falls a game back with 3 weeks left on the schedule. Both of these teams have big games remaining. Wittenberg plays Wabash on the road next week. DePaul will finish the regular season in the Monon Bell game against Wabash. DePaul set to kick it away here. And said to turn the music off after they're ready for play. It was the whistle for ready for play, and the music was still going. So now we're ready. Kick is away. This will be Dean Tate. Tate catches the end-over-end kick at his own 4. Looking to make some noise. Splits two tacklers near the 20. Goes out across the 25. There is a flag down on the opposite side of the field at the 30-yard line. And so we'll see what this penalty is about, and that'll determine where this drive is going to start with 94 seconds left. Still waiting on a signal here. If it's against DePaul, gives the Tigers a little bit better starting position.
Personal foul, illegal block below the waist.
Ooh, it's on Whitburn.
CB team, number 20. The penalty's enforced half the distance to the goal, first down.
So instead, Wittenberg has to start this drive back at their own 13-yard line. Max Milton has thrown for 347 yards today. His favorite target has been Tyler May. May has a majority of those yards, 231 receiving. And Wittenberg will look at first and 10 from their own 13. So start this drive. Garrett Gross is in as the tailback, Milton in the gun. Hands it to Gross. He's out across the 15, and that's about it. A gain of a couple with 1:24 remaining.
And again, the key there is running the clock. Try to get a first down. A first down will get you to the end, and then we'll have a shootout.
Yeah, Jim Collins not in a hurry up here. Tigers not in their 2-minute mode. So playing it rather conservatively, playing for overtime, it looks like. Final minute of regulation. Yeah, they're going to milk this clock here. Play clock down to 12. Handoff Gross, cuts it back at the 20, gets hit hard and toppled over near the 22. So it'll be third down and 2 to go after a pickup of 5 yards for Gross. DePaul coaches, I think, were trying to decide whether or not they should call a timeout, but they're not going to. Third down, two to go. There is about a three-second difference between the game clock and the play clock. So Wittenberg does have to snap it one more time. But since DePaul's not using their final timeout, any play that lasts over 3 seconds is going to take this game to overtime. So with 4 seconds left, Jim Collins will call that timeout. Wittenberg still has one left, but it doesn't look like they're going to need it or use it.
And again, Scott, this is a situation that Wittenberg's been in before, a real tough game against Denison, went to overtime. And so they've been through this situation before. What a game.
Yeah, DePaul rallies back to tie the game at 35 apiece. They score twice here in the fourth quarter after
Amazing.
Trailing by 14. It was a Gabe Quigley 3-yard run that capped off a 7-play, 75-yard drive with 6:34 remaining. And that made it a touchdown game.
Yeah. Well, they led by 13, and then, again, they it went to 14.
Yeah, and then with 1:41 to go, that Cahill 2-yard keeper and the PAT ties the game. So, now, Milton's in the victory formation. He's going to take a knee. And DePaul will let the clock run out. I was going to say, if he takes a knee too soon, if you're DePaul, maybe you call timeout and make them
right.
run a fourth down play.
Right.
But we go to overtime here in Springfield, celebrating 100 years of Wittenberg Stadium
That's
and
amazing.
Edwards Maurer Field. We've got a good one here.
Yep.
35 apiece after regulation. Stay tuned. Overtime coming up here on the Tiger Sports Network. We go to overtime here in Springfield, Wittenberg and DePaul in a battle for first place in the North Coast Athletic Conference. Each team gets to send one captain representative to midfield. Let's listen in.
We're going to play on, right? Both teams will get one timeout per overtime period. Starting with the second overtime, after a touchdown, you must go for two. Starting with the third overtime, every play is a two-point conversion. Any questions? Okay. DePaul, you're the visitor, you're going to call the toss. This is the head, and that's the tail. This is the head, and that's the tail. I'll call it before I toss it for Dominic to hear. Tail, call. It's a tail, he's won the ball. Which end of the field do you want to play on down there? DePaul has won the toss, he likes to play defense. Wittenberg grab the ball first and 10 on this end of the field. So the guys out.
So DePaul wins the toss, and they wisely decide to bat in the bottom half of the inning, if you will. They will play defense first, and so Wittenberg's offense and Max Milton will go to work from the 25-yard line. We'll play from the north end of the field down to our left as we see it from our broadcast location here inside the steamer. And Coach Scobie, it has been one of those games where DePaul has missed some opportunities. Wittenberg has taken advantage of some opportunities. DePaul able to pull their feet out of the fire late in the game with two touchdowns to force overtime. In theory, DePaul has the momentum going into overtime, but I'm guessing the coaches down there would tell you that all changes as soon as the first snap of overtime begins. It's about winning each play.
Well, I think you're right, and I think that's a critical point to make, Scott, because I think you've got to make your momentum right now. It's a clean slate. And you've got to play your very best football. Everything you've got has to happen here in the next few minutes.
Milton fakes the handoff to Anderson, throws to Tyler May, who tried to break free but is tackled back at the 28, a loss of 3 yards. Nice tackle made by Nolan Tully, the junior safety in space. If he doesn't make that tackle, May is going to have a big gain.
Yeah, that was a great tackle by him. And, again, the only thing with that play, again, it was thrown to the outside. And, you know, Tyler has made his day on going downfield and making cuts. He's hard to guard.
Here's Milton to throw on second down and 12. Throwing the deep ball, and it's caught, but out of bounds is Dean Tate. Tate, a one-handed grab on the near sideline as he was about 3 yards deep in the end zone, but he had to adjust too much to get to that ball, and both feet were out of bounds.
Yeah, that was a critical play there because it's first down and you need 10, and they go for it all right there in the corner. A big catch by Tate, but
now,
he just got driven out. Now you basically got to have a big third down and 12.
You're probably not even going to attempt a field goal from here.
No.
So from here, it's really two down territory.
Yeah.
You're probably looking at needing two plays to try and get 12 yards.
Yep.
Because you'd be talking about a 43-yard field goal somewhere in that area. Timeout Wittenberg, so Jim Collins is going to use their timeout right here to talk about this play before third and 12 from the 27. So Tyler May, who's been the deep threat, one of the things that happens in overtime, because you start the 25, you don't have all that real estate to work with. So you can't really throw a deep, deep ball to Tyler May. Instead, they tried to get it to him behind the line of scrimmage and let him create in space, but Tully made a nice tackle. Then they do throw it deep down the sideline for Tate. He can't haul it in and keep a foot down. So you're backed up to third and 12, Wittenberg, here at home in overtime, tied at 35. Do you want to say hello to our friend and regular listener, Bob Fisher's tuned in.
Hey, says Bobby.
It's great to have us on the call. Said, need a Tiger up here late in the game.
Absolutely.
And Bob and many others tuned in today from all over the country, all over the world, as we hear from folks overseas all the time and all around the planet who are watching Wittenberg football. And they've been treated to a good one here today as Wittenberg and DePaul try to settle this thing in overtime. Milton in the shotgun. Three receivers. Has time. Throws. And it's out of bounds Malik Bo was way out of bounds when he came back to the football. So I don't know if Bo got pushed out, if the route took him out of bounds, but Emmanuel Duo was on coverage. It's incomplete, and it's now 4th and 12, and so this is it for Wittenberg. If they're going to come away with points here in overtime, they've got to convert.
Yeah, this is a very difficult play, and I would expect DePaul will probably, you know, come after Max Milton. You look for a play to Tate. You look for a play, maybe a crossing pattern to get the first down.
Here's Milton. Has time. He's throwing deep down the field to the end zone, a little underthrown and broken up. He was looking for Dean Tate, and if he lets that ball fly just a shade earlier, maybe Tate is able to catch it in stride. But Tate had to take a little bit off in the end zone, about 5 yards deep, and it's knocked away. And so DePaul will take over on downs from the 25, and any points here win it for the DePaul Tigers.
Again, a good play to Tate. He's the guy you want to try to get it to. He had two guys hanging on him, but the ball, again, maybe wasn't as thrown as well, but it was a long pass, but, man, it was close.
Bob Fisher, by the way, tuned in from Spokane, Washington.
How about that?
Out in the Pacific Northwest. All right, it's going to be DePaul's turn here in overtime. 35-35 tie. Nathan McCahill will work from the shotgun. Whitehead is the running back. Whitehead's had success on the ground today. They'll give it to him. No surprise there, and he'll push forward to the 22. Gain of 3 yards. And it brings up second down and 7.
Yeah, they just run it off left tackle, and Whitehead has had a tremendous second half. I mean, he has put up some serious numbers, and he's the go-to guy, I would say, right now. Just pound it, pound it, pound it, and, you know, get in field goal position.
Three receivers out to the right. McCahill hands to Whitehead, running left. He's got room. He's inside the 20, down to the 15, and he's taken down at the 14. That's good enough for a DePaul first down, and they're at that spot now where you figure they would be content to kick a field goal and win it from here, so I wouldn't expect to DePaul to take many chances, probably keep it on the ground with Whitehead again. First
no
and
doubt.
10 from the 14.
Wind is behind their back, so they've got a nice setup there. And as you said, Scott, this is a place where, you know, you just – Wittenberg needs a mistake, and DePaul –
Give it to Whitehead, running left, cuts it back inside the 10, down to the 8. He's down near the 6. Official waving to run the clock, but there is no clock in overtime, so it won't make a difference. Second down and 1 from the 6. DePaul trying to get to 8-0. They will host Kenyon next week and then be off before they play at Wabash for the Monon Bell game on November 11th. Wittenberg makes that trip to Crawfordsville next week to take on Wabash. DePaul trying to stay atop the NCAC standings here on second down and 1. Give to Whitehead. He's going to have the first down. He is inside the 5 to the 4. First and goal from the 4. So probably a couple more running plays, and if they don't score on either one of them, you might even see DePaul try and kick the field goal before fourth down.
I think they will. I think you're in a situation now where you just don't want to make mistakes. Bring the guy in and kick the field goal.
First and goal from the 4-yard line here in overtime. Wittenberg went 3 and out, unable to come away with points. DePaul scored 14 points late in the game in the final 6.5 minutes or so. Handoff Whited. He's going to be grabbed around the 3 and pushed back.
Penalty on the play.
And there is a flag down, some pushing and shoving here at the end of this play. There is a flag down that came from behind the defense, maybe from the umpire. I'm not sure who is going to get flagged here, but if it's against DePaul, it pushes them back from this first down and goal inside the 5 advantage and makes it a little tougher. If it's against Wittenberg, though, there's a personal foul.
Face mask.
Four penalties have just hurt the Tigers here in the second half.
Well, they've had a few of, I think that's the third personal foul face mask against Wittenberg.
Yeah.
And a couple of them have been
on
in
offense.
Been in traffic. Yeah, one was on an offensive lineman, I believe. This one was in kind of a rugby scrum near the end of the play. One was on a receiver who was blocking, and the play was basically going out of bounds. Yeah, three of those face mask calls that have hurt Wittenberg either on offense or on defense.
DePaul now
in the second
just,
half.
Just needs a 1 yard gain.
Yeah, first and goal from the two. Give it to Whitehead. He's slowed down. He lunges forward. He's close. And is he in or not? No signal. DePaul thinks they've scored. And the linesman over here.
There's a flag that's on the field.
Kind of put his two arms up as he was running in, but didn't fully signal touchdown. I guess it's over. We're gonna see a fight now. The officials completely lost control here at the end. They didn't make a signal.
They didn't make
a signal.
And
now they're just going to run off the field. So DePaul rallies, and they win it in overtime to stay unbeaten. And they'll win it by a final of 41-35 as the officials cowardly jog towards the locker room. And that's the way this one will come to a close here at Edwards-Mauer Field. So DePaul goes to 8-0 on the year. They stay unbeaten in conference play. And Wittenberg will suffer its first NCAC loss. And so maybe the beginning of a little bit of a rivalry between these two, a series Wittenberg has thoroughly dominated over the years. But DePaul will win it here in Springfield today. And maybe we'll get a little bit of what we have with Wittenberg and Wabash going forward, a nice fully fledged NCAC rivalry.
And normally they all line up on the 50 and go up and shake hands, but Wittenberg is leaving the field. I think looked like the coaches said, you know, just go back and get away from him. This has got to be just a heartbreaker to the Tigers. They felt like they had this one. And but how about DePaul? They never gave up.
Big win for DePaul in a game
win.
That they were behind basically the entire day.
The whole day.
And again, we talked about their ability in the fourth quarter to come up with big plays when they needed them, to rally back from a couple touchdowns down. They force overtime. Wittenberg decides we're going to just play for overtime. And so the Tigers basically run the clock out to get to overtime, but then they go three and out in that first possession, and that allows DePaul then to win it with any points, but they didn't need to settle for the field goal. They punch it in on the Whitehead run, and so that's how DePaul gets the victory here today at Edwards-Mauer Field. 41-35, DePaul victorious. For the coach, Jim Scobie, for our producer, Jackson Lightcap, for our entire crew, thanks so much for watching. As DePaul defeats Wittenberg in a battle for first place in the conference here.